Rob, what a day for football and what an atmosphere at a sold-out Jones AT&T Stadium. Three times in the last decade, a top five team has come in here and gotten dropped by Texas Tech. There is number three, the Horned Frogs, taking on Texas Tech in a meeting of 3-0 teams in this Big 12 opener. TCU and Texas Tech ready to roll from Lubbock. Welcome inside. Joe Davis with Brady Quinn. Chris Button joins us in just a moment. Now, here's a fair warning. If defense is your thing, you might want to look away. These two offenses, high-powered, and usually when that's the case, Brady, it starts with the guys pulling the trigger. No different in this one. We're going to talk both of them. Let's start off with the Heisman candidate for TCU and Trevon Boykin.
Yeah, everything really centers around Trevon Boykin, who's gotten better and better and better this year. At his best game last week versus SMU, 5 touchdown passes and 1 on the ground, and that's what makes Trevon Boykin so special. He's sensational getting outside the pocket and then hurting you with his legs. And he's really had to carry a team that struggled on the defensive side of the football this year with all those injuries.
He's a household name at this point. Everybody knows about Trevon Boykin. People are starting to learn about Patrick Mahomes, a sophomore who's been really good so far for Texas Tech.
Yeah, one of the most underrated quarterbacks in the country, already accounting for 13 touchdowns in just 3 games. He adds that other element of being a dual threat guy, being able to run and hurt you with his feet as well. And believe me, he's going to have his work cut out for him going up against Trevon Boykin and that potent TCU offense today.
This is only the 5th time since 1980 that two teams averaging at least 49 points per game have gone head-to-head. I think it's going to be some fun in Lubbock today. TCU and Texas Tech kick it off on the other side of the break. College football is presented by Geico. That was one of the 57 meetings between these programs just last year. It's a series that Texas Tech has the all-time advantage in, but those 82 points TCU put up a season ago, a Big 12 record. For more on that one and Texas Tech coming into this one, here's Chris Button.
Well, when you look back at that game, that's one that the Red Raiders would probably like to forget, but their coach, Cliff Kingsbury, said, "Not so fast, gentlemen." Instead, made a highlight reel of every TCU touchdown and celebration and showed it to him this week. He said, "I wanted to remind my guys what it felt like to give up." He said, "The difference this year, I know TCU's going to score, but I feel like this is a team that's going to keep fighting."
Chris, he is 36 years old, the youngest Power Conference head coach, and there's Gary Patterson, 18th season overall at TCU, 15th as the head coach. That makes him one of the longest tenured coaches in the country. There were some showers as this place was filling up, but it's dry now. Storms in the area, but we're clear for kickoff. Texas Tech won the toss and is elected to receive. Oberkron boots it away, and Jakeem Grant out of his own end zone. And Grant takes it across the 25. So that is where the nation's number 3 offense will begin. Brady, give us 3 things we need to know.
It all starts with Patrick Mahomes. He's been very effective through the air and on his feet. And he's going to be looking for Jakeem Grant throughout the game, a very versatile player. You'll see him all over the field. And for TCU, they get back Davion Pearson, number 57 up front. They could use some of that senior leadership with all the injuries that defense has had to endure this year.
And not starting. Yeah, you mentioned it. The issues his defense has gone through with attrition. They already had to replace 6 of last year's top 7 tacklers. Now down 7 projected starters for different reasons. From the 27, Texas Tech gets it going with a Patrick Mahomes designed throw. He'll tuck it and get across the line of scrimmage. Mahomes, a sophomore, leading this offense, averaging 54 points per game.
One of the biggest keys about Mahomes is he doesn't have many really negative plays. He hasn't taken any sacks so far this year, and you see right there, didn't have anything, still gets positive yards.
Got 1, 2nd and 9. They get it outside quickly to Jakeem Grant.
who uses a block from Reggie Davis to get across the 30, and we get our first third down of the game on this opening Texas Tech possession.
Joe, both teams like to spread the field, and they like to put their playmakers in space. So really it's going to come down to which defense tackles better in space. TCU so far being able to wrap up Jakeem Grant, which is not an easy task.
Opening drive for the Red Raiders and a third down and 5. Pressure off of the edge. Mahomes gets rid of it just in time, and Grant, normally reliable, drops it. It's fourth down.
In a big game, starting in Big 12 play, sometimes you got some of those nerves going on, especially at the wide receiver position. Jakeem Grant with one catch, but on third down, a critical situation. I'd like to see him be a little more cool and calm and bring that one in.
Now how about Texas Tech already having more punts than they did last week? And the win against Arkansas. Their punter is a good one. He just doesn't get a ton of work. Taylor Samant. They send it away to the dangerous freshman, Cavante Turpin. Over his head into the end zone. Boy, that thing on the fly. Close to 70 yards. And so TCU ready to begin its first possession. Give us three things we need to know.
Trevon Boykin had his best game of the season last week versus SMU. 5 touchdowns through the air, 1 on the ground. And to balance out that running attack, Aaron Green in the backfield. He's a just overall tremendous back. And then really for Texas Tech, you look at up front, big number 10, Pete Robertson. He's going to be the guy that's going to be responsible. We're trying to get pressure on Boykin and even spying him a little bit from keeping him from getting outside the pocket.
His defense is near the bottom of the Big 12 in most categories, but staying afloat because they're getting takeaways. Top 10 in the country and forcing turnovers. From the 20, it's a trick play to begin with Turpin throwing the ball for Slanina. How about Gary Patterson pulling out a trick for a 15-yard gain to get the offense's day start?
Definitely not what Texas Tech expected this early in the game. So a little trickeration, trying to catch this Texas Tech defense off their heels right now. Unbelievable to start the game.
It's one of the nation's top offenses, averaging just under 50 points per game. Play action, and there's a shot for Josh Dotson. Their top receiver crosses midfield, and another TCU first down.
And Dotson's gotten so much better at catching a lot of those intermediate routes and shorter routes. He's really just a big play wide receiver and a red zone threat. But now he's really a complete wide receiver. He worked on that a lot this past spring and in training camp.
Two plays for the Horned Frogs to move it into Texas Tech territory. And Aaron Green's first run goes for a short gain. Micah Awe was there with Rika Levy. And second down coming up.
We talked about some of the keys for Texas Tech's defense. Really tackling. You go back to that Sam Houston State game, it was closer than it really should have been, in part because the defense just didn't tackle well. A lot of missed tackles throughout that game.
Turpin motions out of the backfield, and they swing it out to him. And Cavante Turpin navigates his way for close to a first down. And J.J. Gaines over to make the tackle. And it looks like they have spotted him with it off. It is a TCU first down.
Boy, is Turpin special. You know, they try to get him the ball in space, and then he makes the rest happen. Saw a little bit of his elusiveness right there, but last week, got a quick slant, took it to the house, and he's got a ton of speed.
It's an embarrassment of riches for Trevon Boykin to work with. For an offense that last year averaged just under 50 points per game as well. First down from the 39. Boykin wanted to swing it out to White, instead will slide, and that's one of the things Gary Patterson emphasized this week. He thought that Boykin had been taking too many hits lately.
Yeah, I mean, and one thing about Boykin that's interesting, though, is as many hits as he takes, he's also good at being able to get down and avoid some of those other hits.
9 second and 9, looking over the middle and pulled in. First down and goal with Desmond White making the catch, working against Deshaun Johnson.
Well, Sonny Cubby talked about some of the things Trevon Boykin worked on this past spring. That was some of those seam throws, and right there he finds number 10, Desmond White, up the seam. They'd like to get him more involved in the offense.
Green into a crowd of red shirts. On a short gain, Demetrius Alston credit for the tackle. Second down and goal. And TCU moves into the red zone where they've had 14 touchdowns and 18 trips. It's pretty darn good. Top five in college football.
And that's every team's goal, right, is to score touchdowns, not field goals. And it's in part because Boykin's so effective in the running game. He's an option down there that can get into the end zone.
Play action. Boykin into the end zone. Touchdown, TCU. Josh Dotson pulls it in for his fourth of the season. And what a drive to begin for the third-ranked Horned Frogs.
What a drive and what a way to finish with Trevon Boykin finding Josh Dotson in the back end zone. We talked about him being a red zone target. In this case, just runs that back end line. They call that a high back five, meaning you got to put it up high enough where the defenders can't get it. Great ball by Boykin and good job by Josh Dotson finding the hole in the zone.
And after a three and out from Texas Tech, an 80-yard drive in less than 3 minutes for TCU, capped off by a Dotson touchdown reception from Boykin. Big 12 opener between a pair of high-powered offenses and unbeaten teams, and TCU with the first blow. Fox College Football presented by GEICO is sponsored by Bud Light. Stay in the game and drink responsibly. And by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you got to get DirecTV. Some of the 17,000 Texas Tech students expected to pour in here in this sellout crowd. Quite an atmosphere.
It is. That's a lot of tortillas, too, coming out of the stands.
Not penalty flex, depending on who you ask.
Tradition here.
Yeah.
Tortilla Tech, they call it?
Yeah. Scoring drive for TCU. 8 plays, 80 yards, capped off by the Dotson reception. And Boykin was a perfect 4 for 4 on that drive. They keep it away from Jakeem Grant. And whistle it dead inside the 15. Apparently Justin Stockton took a fair catch. And so Texas Tech will start this drive.
The receiver gave a waving signal.
Any gesture,
yep.
Any gesture with raising your hand up or anything like that, the refs are going to try to protect their returner, and they're going to consider that a fair catch.
And so this Texas Tech offense that scored on its opening drive in each of the first three games this season, a three and out on its opening drive, and for the first time this year behind.
And head coach Cliff Kingsbury talked about weathering the storm early. He knew there was going to be some adversity. With as potent as TCU's offense is, they figured there at some point they're going to be down. They're going to have to fight through it.
Mahomes to throw on first down and throws for Davis, who's got it for a first down across the 25. Had a career best 5 catches, couple of touchdowns last week.
Yeah, big game last week, and really their biggest wide receiver size-wise. He does a nice job of using his body to keep defenders away from the football to corral in catches.
From the 25, here's Devin Lauderdale, who's a bigger part of the plan this week. And he shows you why with his speed across the 30 and a cutback inside the 20. 63 yards for Lauderdale and a Texas Tech first down.
Lauderdale didn't have any catches last week, but he was effective blocking for his teammates. This week they want to get him involved early.
And Gary Patterson expected that as well. And sees that reception setting Texas Tech up at the 16. And Mahomes running inside the 5 and lunging for the pylon. He'll spot him out of bounds inside the 5-yard line. And Mahomes gets up limping.
Cliff Kingsbury loves the toughness of Patrick Mahomes when he runs the football. He'd like to have him not take as many shots as he extends for the pylon. But he's got an unbelievable knack for getting outside the pocket and finding ways of making plays in the passing game and running game with his feet.
And in clear pain right now. Got up limping. He stays in the game with the first down and goal for the Red Raiders. Washington in. Touchdown, Texas Tech. But the bigger story right now is the pain that it appears Patrick Mahomes is feeling.
DeAndre Washington's just going to follow his blockers up front. Alfredo Morales, the Raven Clark, the big boys. Not a way of pushing back that TCU defensive line that has seen so much change throughout the course of the season. With injuries, off the field issues, Texas Tech taking advantage.
And that looked a lot more like the Texas Tech offense we saw over the first 3 weeks. Three and out on the first drive. 86 yards and four plays on this second drive. And it's Clayton Hatfield with the rain starting to fall again. Tying the game at 7. It was set up by the 63-yard reception off of the screen from Devin Lauderdale, who was shut out last week at Arkansas, but makes an impact on this one early on. And it leads to a Texas Tech touchdown with DeAndre Washington. And we are locked at 7. Didn't take long to see how Texas Tech would respond to trailing for the first time this year.
Yeah, that's exactly what head coach Cliff Kingsbury would like to see out of his team. Nice little response after trailing for the first time.
Samaek ready to send it away. In a 7-7 game, 9:42 left in this opening quarter. Turpin watches it sail over his head. Let's go back to that play, the key play on that long drive.
And Texas Tech's going to use number 11, Jakeem Grant, to kind of be a decoy here. He's coming in motion. They're going to throw the screen to Devin Lauderdale, and he's going to do the rest. But I want you to look at number 21, DeAndre Washington, hustling down the field. He lays a block that allows Lauderdale to get the additional yards. Unselfishness right there. You love to see that out of your running back, and he ends up being rewarded with the touchdown.
Yeah, and so a 7-7 game in TCU, which looked really impressive on that opening drive, back at it from the 25. Boykin was a perfect 4-for-4 to begin, and plenty of time here to scan the field and find Dotson. He's got his third catch of the day and a first down to the 40.
Joe, only a three-man rush. We talked to defensive coordinator David Gibbs, and he said he's going to mix up his coverages and his blitzes and how he's going to try to confuse Trevon Boykin. He wants him just to slow up and try to confuse him a little bit.
They bring pressure this time, and they swing it out to Green, and it's ruled an incomplete pass. It was borderline there, whether or not that was a pass or backwards, but they call it incomplete.
Check out Trevon Boykin quickly goes to a swing as they set up a screen almost versus the Texas Tech pressure. Hard to tell from that angle.
First incompletion for Boykin. Second and 10 from the 40. Play action. Dotson again. Off to a heck of a start in this one. Fourth reception. 15 yards into Texas Tech territory. Another TCU first down.
TCU offense is so effective with what they call these run-pass options. They've got a run play call, but a pass route right in behind. And they allow that to affect the defense with the run or the pass. You got to pick your poison in that case.
It's four catches now for 53 yards and a touchdown for Dotson. Here comes Green. Met in the hole by Malik Jenkins, who doesn't figure to see as much time today, with Texas Tech spending much of the day in the nickel.
TCU's working a lot to Josh Dotson in the passing game. That's in part because number 7, Colby Lissenby, is battling an undisclosed injury. He's not out there on the field. Emmanuel Porter, number 1, is starting in his plays at the top of the screen.
Good player himself.
Yeah, he's obviously got all the ability. They're confident in him, just not the same type of speed.
A better size than Lissenby. And this one slung sidearm. And Dotson driven out of bounds by Justice Nelson. Third down for the Horned Frogs.
Colby Lissenby, the big 1,200-meter track champion. Warmed up, but not out there on the field. Now we'll see if Texas Tech will decide to bring more heat on Trevon Boykin, or just a three-man pass rush and try to play coverage.
First third down of the day faced by TCU's offense.
One player to keep an eye on is number 10, Pete Robertson. He's going to be spying Trevon Boykin throughout the day in case he leaves the pocket.
Confident throw to the sideline for Dotson. They say that he did get a foot down, but short of the sticks, defended by Gaines. Fourth down and a couple of yards coming up.
Decided to play coverage on a three-man rush. Starting to make Trevon Boykin and TCU go the long, hard way.
So the Horned Frogs will go for it after a timeout. And this, if they do decide to go for it, will be trying to get it, or trying to convert it for the first time this year. Back in just a moment. Well, during the timeout, former Red Raider Zach Thomas was honored in front of this sellout crowd going into the College Football Hall of Fame this year. And Red Raiders would like to have him on this fourth down play coming up.
Yeah, they would. Undersized player in his career, but played with so much heart and passion and effort. He earned his way into the College Football Hall of Fame.
Big play early in this game, fourth down and four. And it's a quick kick for Boykin. Shanked it. Well, tough when you ask a quarterback to do that.
Yeah, I mean, he's so effective in so many ways, just not necessarily punting the football. That might be his only weakness.
Yeah, he can run, he can throw, he played receiver, played running back.
Running back, yeah. Yeah.
But not a great punter.
Probably didn't do so well in that punt, pass, and kick contest.
No, right.
Just in the passing part.
And we saw Patrick Mahomes banged up on that last drive. Chris Budden, you've got more.
Yeah, he came over. The medical staff looked at both of his legs. He told them, I'm fine. He walked around. They did put on a brace on that left knee as a precaution, Joe.
All right, Chris, and you see the rain starting to fall. And that brace on that left leg. Down the field in the blink of an eye last time they had it. First down from the 20. Mahomes well protected. Off of the hands and incomplete. Grant was defended by Traven Howard, and it's second and 10.
And it really takes away an element of Texas Tech's offense if Mahomes can't run quite as well as he has the first 3 weeks. Talking to Gary Patterson, he talked about having to play against Mahomes is like having to cover an extra gap in the running game.
And here's a snap that sails right by him into the end zone for a safety. Washington hustled back to fall on it, and TCU jumps in front with the 2 points.
Obviously a miscommunication between Mahomes and center Jared Caster, captain of this team. And wisely, DeAndre Washington gets back on the football and just takes the safety, but clearly, there's no communication going on right there between the center and the quarterback. Not exactly sure what Caster might have heard.
And not normally a problem you see the home team have. So you're not dealing with any crowd. 9-7 TCU. Fox College Football presented by GEICO is sponsored by Advil. Fast and strong on tough pain. And by the U.S. Army. It is pouring. An intermittent rain and sun today, but it's pouring right now. Fox Sports supports, proud to team with Boys and Girls Clubs of America, supporting their mission and helping young people to reach their full potential through programs that promote character and leadership, education, healthy lifestyles, and more. For more information, visit foxsportssupports.com. And so now ball security becomes even more of a story in this game with two high-powered offenses. Semenk boots it away, and here comes Kevonte Turpin. And Turpin steps out of one tackle and takes it across the 35-yard line. Time for a Lowe's game break. We check in for the first time with Jenny Tech.
Thanks, Joe. Number 24, Oklahoma State visiting Texas. The Longhorns going for it on fourth and two. Tyrone Swoops takes it in for the touchdown. Charlie Strong and the Longhorns trying to avoid their first 1-3 start since 1956. Texas up 20-17 at half. Joe Brady, back to you.
And what a change for Texas on offense, changing quarterbacks from Tywon Swoops to Jerod Hurd. He's added an element of efficiency and dynamic ability out of outside running the football as well. And change in offensive coordinator as well. Jay Norville taking over for Sean Watson.
And how about this? Bram Kohlhausen came out at first, and now it's Boykin back in. TCU fans held their breath for a moment there. I mean, it is really coming down right now. The game clock, the play clock runs down and out. And Boykin comes back to the sideline. Kohlhausen remains on the field.
Kohlhausen was very efficient in the short amount of time he played versus SF Austin a couple weeks ago.
Hands it off to Green on first down. He's got a short gain. That defensive line has done a nice job against the run so far.
Yeah, and it really helps open up the linebackers for Texas Tech, in particular number 18, Micah Awe, coming through, making the tackle there. He's been battling some shoulder injuries, but was able to wrap up and get Aaron Green down.
Boykin back in after that one play, second down and eight. Green again, not much there. Brandon Jackson, most experienced player on this Texas Tech defense, sets up third down and long.
Brandon Jackson's got a lot of ability, built like one of those NFL rush ends. Just a matter of consistency. Can he do it throughout the course of a game, the course of a season?
Third and seven.
Texas Tech in man-to-man coverage. Look out for the matchup on Dotson.
Look in that direction. Dotson going deep. Perfectly thrown and pulled in. What a toss by Boykin. And Dotson beats Madison for 36 yards.
Boy, is that pretty. I mean, Trevon Boykin just laying it out to Dotson, who's got the extension to make the catch. These two are special.
His seventh catch of this opening quarter. That's Kyle Hicks with his first carry as we go back to that long completion.
Nothing special about this. This is just one-on-one coverage. Trevon Boykin does a nice job laying the ball to the outside where the defender cannot get it. And Dotson with the hands to bring it in over Paul Banks at cornerback.
Yeah, seldom used Paul Banks. With as fast as TCU goes, Texas Tech having to roll in several bodies to keep up the defensive back spots. On second and one, Boykin off play action. Throwing for the end zone. Desmond White can't run under it. And it will be third down. That is not a flag. It's a tortilla that came in the back of the end zone. I saw you putting your hands up as if to protect me from saying PI.
Oh, well, sometimes it can be tough to determine whether or not it's a tortilla or a flag. But
nothing like wet tortillas.
It's interesting seeing tight ends in the game for TCU right now. They only had one catch in the season. It was last week versus SMU. Finally getting one catch, and it was a touchdown. It was a big one.
And we joked around with Sonny Cumbie, the offensive coordinator, yesterday. Said he think we'll see more, and he goes, whoa, back-to-back weeks using the tight end. And here it's Boykin sneaking it for a first down up to the 12.
TCU doesn't get under center much. When they do, you can almost guarantee it's either a quarterback sneak or in a two-minute situation, they're going to spike the football. But that's about it.
It's odd right now. Sun on the field, but it continues to rain pretty hard. With a first down and 10 from the 11 for Trevon Boykin in this offense.
Desmond White in the slot. He's a guy TCU likes, and they'd like to get him more involved in the offense.
Here's Green trying to get outside. Able to turn the corner for a pickup of five. Nudged out by Awe, second down.
Desmond White, we talked about. He's a Dallas-Fort Worth area legend from DeSoto High School. Tremendous quarterback, converted to wide receiver. A little bit of a slow start to the season. Had a great game versus Minnesota. Now just trying to kind of get his reins getting back into the game.
They go back to Green off the left side, and he's close to a first down. Tackle made by Levy, third and short.
Vitae and Knaff on the left side, really paving the way. They brought over Joseph Noboom, right tackle, to help as an eligible tight end to help block as well.
What are you looking for on third and two?
In this particular case, I'd imagine it's going to be some sort of power run, given they still got their two tight ends in Buck Jones and Dominic Mirka.
It is Mirka leading the way for Green, who lunges forward and has a first down. Needed the one and got inside it. First down and goal as TCU converts its third down of this drive.
Well, Murka and Jones do a nice job leading the way for Aaron Green, help pave holes and create a little bit of movement up front in these power situations. And talking about short yardage and goal line, essentially are the fullbacks for TCU. They don't carry any on their team.
So Murka remains in there. With White or Green still getting a heavy load on this possession. It's Green hurtling his way over the goal line for a touchdown.
Aaron Green holding the ball carry for a TCU touchdown.
See the hops of Aaron Green there. Really not much push up front, but enough. And Aaron Green able to elevate. Tremendous athlete, complete back, does it all. Catches out of the backfield, has the speed and power to run short yardage in normal situations.
On a drive where TCU goes as slow as you'll ever see him go.
I wonder if that's a product of their defense and some of these injuries and wanting not to have to put as much of a burden going up against a high-powered Texas Tech offense.
And TCU's offense off to a good start in this one, especially Josh Dotson. How about that reception off a beautiful throw from Boykin? And they slowly worked their way down to the goal line and capped it off with an Aaron Green touchdown run. It's 16-7 TCU. Dotson on the right set it up, and then Green finished it off with a touchdown run. And after the safety, the Horned Frogs march down for the score, and it's 16-7. Who would have thought we'd see a safety in this game between high-powered offenses? Jakeem Grant brings it out of the end zone. He's taken three back for touchdowns in his career. And Grant takes it all the way across midfield. So Texas Tech will begin in TCU territory off with a big play from the senior.
Grant fielded it so low to the ground, I almost thought he took a knee. And then he comes out of there like a rocket. He's so low to the ground, he has the ability to make one cut and change direction dramatically. And then the speed to break away. He's a special player. Texas Tech tries to get him the ball in as many ways as possible. Last week threw a touchdown pass on a reverse.
Look at that. Only guy in the country that has a touchdown passing, running, receiving, and on a return. And he's the only guy in Texas Tech history to do it. He's done it in the first three games this year. Straight ahead they go, DeAndre Washington. The interior of that TCU defense shuts it down, second and nine. Ty Summers in there for the tackle, part of this young linebacking core, along with Howard and Wilson, both converted safeties.
Denzel Johnson's been the guy that really sticks out. Had a huge impact, filling in the big shoes of Sam Carter left behind. He's done a great job this year. Instead of got their strong safety spot right out here on the slot.
Mahomes looking in his direction. Lauderdale goes up and gets it. And chopped down immediately by Nick Orr, a yard short, third and one for Texas Tech.
This is two down territory for Texas Tech. I mean, they don't really even know who their field goal kicker is. So they'll have a couple opportunities to get a first down here.
Yeah, both Hatfield and Barden have tried field goals. Their longest field goal this year is 33 yards. On third and one, it's Washington for a first down. DeAndre Washington thrown down by Kindred after a run of 16.
An easy decision there. Third and one, give the ball to DeAndre Washington. He averages 8 yards a carry this season. You really can make a guy miss and get upfield. Very explosive running back.
Back to him on first down. Steps out of a tackle. Washington for the Texas Tech touchdown.
They like running to this left side because of left tackle, LaRaven Clark. One of the best tackles in the Big 12. He helps pave the way. Little zone read, and you're gonna see DeAndre Washington do the rest. He's a tough runner, and then he's got the speed to be able to get away.
It is a misnomer that this Texas Tech team is all air. They run it about 40% of the time. They're top 10 in the country in yards per carry.
It's 1,000 yards rushing last year. I mean, he's a very, very productive back, and they like to have that balance.
Yeah, they've got Texas Tech back to within two in this shootout in Lubbock. Andre Washington, senior from Missouri City, Texas. You mentioned his 1,000-yard season last year. It was the first time since the 90s that Texas Tech had a 1,000-yard rusher.
Ricky Williams.
Yeah.
1998. Not the one for Texas.
No.
The one for Texas Tech. 1,500 yards that season.
Kyle Hicks back to return this one along with Turpin. And Taylor Samank to boot it away. And doing a nice job of neutralizing the dangerous Turpin right now. When we finish, our full day of college football continues with a big top 20 matchup. 18th ranked Utah and 13th ranked Oregon. With coverage starting right after our game right here on Fox, sponsored by Geico. What do you like in that one?
Tough call. In Oxon, I would have to go with the Ducks. I really think they're on their way to finding themselves in the Pac-12 championship game. I know they suffered a loss versus Michigan State early, but that was a hard-fought game in East Lansing, and I think they'll be able to run through the Pac-12 North.
How about those numbers for Boykin? He's the only active player with more than 10,000 total yards. That includes his time as a receiver. Saw his 257 receiving yards during his career. From the 25, with the rain having stopped, dumps off his screen for Green, and there is Pete Robertson dropping him at the line of scrimmage.
The senior sniffed it out. As Trevon Boykin kept dropping back, you could tell Robertson got the feeling that there was something else going on with these offensive linemen releasing. Heady play.
Ball snap, play on. And Boykin gets swallowed up. Now Ty Slanina down to the near side of the screen had moved, and everybody kind of stopped thinking it was a penalty. It wasn't. The ball was snapped. Play on.
Well, again, another snap early. It seemed like it was before maybe Trevon Boykin expected it. We saw that for the Texas Tech offense. These early game jitters still aren't out of their system yet.
Nine men up near the line of scrimmage with the two high safeties for Tech on third down and nine. Against a three-man rush, Boykin drills a strike for Slanina into a tight window against J.J. Gaines. First down, TCU, and Slanina rolls his way off of the field in pain.
That's a big injury for TCU. They use Slanina a lot of times in these run-action passes on critical situations like third down, especially in the middle of the field. He's got great hands. He's a solid route runner. Comes down hard on that left shoulder.
And TCU thinking, here we go again. All the injuries they've dealt with this year. Stayed relatively healthy last year in the 12-1 season. But luck has not been on their side in this department this season.
Yeah, fortunately for TCU, they've got a ton of talent at the wide receiver position. You hate to see a guy get injured, but they've got some reinforcements, you could say, at least at that spot on the team.
Gary Patterson getting tested this year with his injuries. He continues to have that next man up mentality, plug and play.
How many times can you say it?
Right.
I mean, over and over and over again, eventually it's going to catch up with him.
You see Colby Lissenby with a towel around his neck there. He's one of the standout receivers. And he's dealing with injuries right now as well. It's been mostly the defense, though, that's been dealing with these injuries. The offense starting to trickle in as well. But you look, since last season, one of the top defenses in the Big 12, everything that they've gone through since, with the departures to begin with. So they had to replace six of their top seven tacklers already. But now they're down seven starters that they projected to have coming into the season. You've got a couple of converted safeties at linebacker. You've got 12 players that have made their first career starts for this defense this year.
Joe, it looks like we were playing Keno there for a second.
Yeah. Did
all
we
those
win?
Different numbers changing. I don't think we did.
Dang.
It's really a credit, though, to Gary Patterson, his ability as a coach to be able to plug guys in and coach them up, teach them their assignment with relatively no experience. One of the best defensive minds in the game. Very, very respected. And I think this season, if they could make it to the college football playoff, you could say it'd be his best season of coaching, given the fact of what he's had to deal with.
Yeah, Jarrison Stewart comes in for Slanina. Sean Nixon out there as well now, motion out of the backfield. On first down from the 40, they pump the screen, throw over the middle for Stewart. And the freshman takes it inside the 30. You mentioned it, next man up. There's the guy in for Slanina, taking it for 31 yards.
The freshman out of Mesquite, Texas. He's got a little burst to him too. Whether it's Jarrison Stewart, Desmond White, Kevontae Turpin, all these guys, once they get the ball in their hands, they're dangerous in the open field.
Speed option into the short side. That one bounced into the hands of Nixon, who takes it close to the sticks. They give him 8, second down and 2.
Sean Nixon, number 3, is an interesting story. He was originally committed to Texas A&M. He was a late decommit where he ended up coming to TCU, and they've really utilized him in a bunch of different ways this season. The backfield as a running back at times, and the slot as a slot wide receiver. Very versatile guy, great hands, good route runner, some explosion.
And about like we expected, Brady, a lot of points in this opening quarter. Couple of 3-0 teams in a 16-14 game. The rain has stopped for now. Bright sunshine over this Big 12 opener. We're back to Lubbock after this. Fox College Football is presented by Geico, and back in Lubbock, Texas, ready to begin the second quarter. Horned Frogs in front, 16-14. Javon Boykin off to a good start in this one. 12 of 14 with a 180 and a touchdown.
A balanced attack. So far, 15 pass attempts versus 14 rush attempts. Kind of bucks that idea that the spread is all about passing.
I think both teams have. Tech ran for a score as well. Sean Nixon hit in the backfield and dropped short. So it'll be a third down and a couple of yards here as Johnson and Jackson combine for the tackle.
This is what I like to call the danger zone for the Texas Tech defense. They really need to come up with stops here in the red zone and force TCU to kick field goals and not score touchdowns. Now, very seldom do you ever see TCU huddle. If you're holding right now, this isn't really the rapid pace that we've seen in the past weeks. I'll be curious to see why exactly TCU has slowed things down so much.
It's third down and 2, and they bring a tight end into the backfield to block. He motions out. Snap is over the head of Boykin, who gets rid of it, and it's fourth down. Pressure from Dakota Allen made sure that Boykin couldn't create magic. Couple of bad snaps we've seen.
Now, this is a heck of a play by Trevon Boykin just to be able to get the football in his hands and get it out. Not have to take a sack and then not be in an easier or more makeable field goal range. Heady play by Boykin.
In a game, Brady, where clearly there's two really good offenses and defenses that have struggled, here's a category where TCU's got a distinct advantage. Jaden Oberkrom is the nation's active leader with 61 made field goals in his career. This one from 36. And it's blocked. It was Pete Robertson that blocked it.
We talked about Pete Robertson's impact on this game playing defense, but here's an example of what he's capable of doing on special teams. Robertson able to get skinny and just get his hand up just enough to block the kick from Oberkrom. That was pretty a low kick, and it wasn't that long of a field goal. 36 yards, you should be able to get a little more trajectory in the football to get it over the defensive line.
Right after we say this is the one spot where TCU's got a distinct advantage. Yeah, that's usually how it works. Mahomes back out there with the Texas Tech offense from the 37. Over the middle for Jakeem Grant. They've been all over him so far. That is Denzel Johnson, who you've praised over the first quarter of this game.
Yeah, he's done a nice job of filling those big shoes of Sam Carter in that strong safety position. That's at a very important position for Gary Patterson's defense. They have to be able to play the run extremely effective, but also the pass as well, and he's got both of those capabilities.
Justin Stockton comes in for Texas Tech. Mahomes double clutching and throwing low at the feet of Ian Sadler. And third down and 7. Both of the scoring drives for the Red Raiders today have been lightning quick. They had a 3-and-out on their first drive. And these two sandwiched in between this one.
It's kind of feast or famine for Texas Tech when you were preparing for this game, watching them. They're usually putting together scoring drives or finding a way of punting.
On 3rd and 7. Mahomes well protected, threw low and incomplete. He had Ian Sadler open, but there's a flag down in the backfield.
Looks like it might be a late hit on 94, Josh Caraway.
Penalties have been an issue for TCU this year.
Personal foul, roughing the passer, number 94 of the defense. 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
And that is a drive extender.
Here's Josh Caraway at the bottom of the screen. Tries to use a speed inside move, and no need for that. A late shoulder to a quarterback well after the ball was out of his hand.
Did you get pretty good at buying those?
I don't know if you buy those. I mean, there wasn't much acting to that. Caraway is 250 pounds.
All day to throw. Over the top, Jakeem Grant. Touchdown, Texas Tech. Promptly taking advantage of a mental miscue from TCU.
Well, we were just praising number 30, Denzel Johnson, his ability to fill in for Sam Carter. There's Jakeem Grant. And they really try to match him up in the slot on who they feel is the weakest coverage defender. Mahomes laying it out for Jakeem Grant. It's just too fast.
And they blow the whistle before Texas Tech attempts to sneak one in for 2. So that will not count. Ball had not been made ready, for play.
Cameron Batson tries to sneak in. Well, at the swinging gate. And TCU clearly not ready, but it didn't look like the refs were either.
Looked like outside of Batson, neither was Texas Tech. He had to push his lineman out of the way. Clayton Hatfield on for the extra point. Texas Tech has its first lead of the day. Boy, this thing turned in a hurry. TCU is lining up for a field goal. They had it blocked. And it looked like they had shut down the drive, but a roughing the passer penalty continues it. Mahomes and Grant make them pay. Huddle up with college football experts and live web chats all season long with a new guest every week. The Edward Jones College Football Huddle on FoxSports.com. You saw Texas Tech prior to the break there utilizing that inside receiver like they've gotten so good at.
That slot wide receiver, and really credit Wes Welker, Danny Amendola for paving the way. And in the offseason, a lot of times Cliff Kingsbury goes up to New England and he talks to those guys about some of those slot receiver concepts and things that they do. And that really has helped out Jakeem Grant in this offense.
So Mank sends it into the end zone, and Turpin will take an E, giving us time for a game break to check in with Jenny Taft.
Well, Joe and Brady have the injuries caught up with the Irish. Number 6, Notre Dame, having some problems against UMass, but closing seconds of the half, Deshaun Kaiser to Chris Brown, 7 yards for the touchdown. Notre Dame leads 35-20 as the third quarter is about to begin. Joe Brady, back to you.
Kaiser filling in nicely. 2 touchdown passes and a rushing touchdown as well. And C.J. Procise, 125 yards in the first half and a touchdown. So Notre Dame fighting through that injury bug and filling in nicely. A lot of depth on that team.
Seems like injury bug is hitting everybody this year across college
Multiple
football.
Multiple levels too, uh-huh. NFL and college football.
Drive begins with an empty set for Javon Boykin from the 25. Steps into pressure and off of the hands of Dotson. Second down.
Rare drop by Dotson, but credit Brandon Jackson, number 9 for Texas Tech, coming off the edge. Didn't quite get to Boykin in time, but provided enough pressure to force Boykin to get that ball out early.
Now, you were curious to see how David Gibbs would operate this. What have you thought of the way they've approached it so far?
He's a very truthful guy. He's doing exactly what he said. He's mixing up coverages, blitzes, and trying to, again, confuse Trevon Boykin post-snap.
New on second down. Steps up and throws to the sideline. And has a first down, and they'll get more. Desmond White was pushed out of bounds late by Johnson. So Tech on 15 yards.
Deshaun Johnson had a fantastic game last week versus
Arkansas. After the play was over, personal foul. Late hit out of bounds, number 7 of the defense. 15 yards on the end of the run, first down.
It's a shame. He had 16 tackles last week and one tackle for loss. Right here, that was way late, not even close.
We've seen a couple late hits in this game.
Penalties are something that Texas Tech has been much improved on this year, something that plagued them just a year ago.
Yeah, they were one of the most penalized teams in America a season ago. They're best in the Big 12 this year. Here's another trick play. It's covered well. And Boykin's got to send it out of bounds. That's a nice boost for a defense when you can do that against that level of trickery.
Yeah, a lot going on that play. I actually think it was too much. Yeah. Sometimes when you have these double reverse passes, there's so much back and forth that you never really get the defense to move to one side.
And got the ball beyond the line of scrimmage.
And Brad Van Vaart letting folks know why it wasn't an intentional grounding. Got it past the line of scrimmage. And so second down and 10 after the second trick play that we've seen from TCU today. Boykin steps into his throw wide of his intended receiver, Emmanuel Porter, defended by Thierry Guima. And TCU looks at a third down and 10.
Again, plus territory here for TCU. You got to figure they're going to work the ball to one of their playmakers. Josh Dotson, number 9, Desmond White. Dotson just subbed in for Juwan Story at the top of the screen. Texas Tech playing a lot of zone coverage. Sometimes it's hard to find them.
They rush only 4. Time for Boykin, but the pocket collapses. Boykin takes off and well short of the first down. Malik Jenkins, the first one there. It's 4th down and 6, kind of in between territory here. And the decision for Gary Patterson.
I don't think it's going to be another quick kick after that experiment the first time. Won't be surprised if they ended up punting it here, trying to pin back Texas Tech.
And it looks like they will. A rare punt in this matchup.
And credit Pete Robertson. Did a nice job getting pressure. Wasn't able to bring down Boykin, but enough to make him flush outside the pocket and unable to pick up the first down. Number 10 having a great game.
Ethan Carey, 4-year starter at punter. Trying to pin him deep. And that one goes into the end zone. Well, it was well done, but Juwan Story unable to keep it from breaking the plane. And Texas Tech back on offense with his newfound lead. From the 20-yard line with a sophomore, Pat Mahomes, directing the show. Texas Tech trying to pull the upset of number 3. Fox College Football presented by GEICO is sponsored by FanDuel, the leader in one-week fantasy football. And by Dr. Pepper and college football, it's a one-of-a-kind tradition. Big piece coming back this week for that TCU defense and Davion Pearson. We go down to Chris Budden.
Well, it's also what he provides his teammates on the sidelines during that last series, telling his guys it's time to stop being nice. Gary Patterson told us just having him back in the team meetings this week has been so important for the rest of these younger guys.
It really has, and this defensive line has taken a lot of hits. Number 92, Bryson Henderson's in for an undisclosed injury, number 90, Trell Lathan.
Mahomes, a play action on first down. Coverage downfield is good, so he's got to throw the ball into the feet of Sadler, second down.
Well, Mahomes doesn't seem to be moving quite as well or as fluid as he was before he went down earlier in the game. I think that knee might be bothering him a little bit. That's why he's been hanging the football off and not necessarily running outside the pocket.
It's a different offense when you take away his ability to run.
Yeah, and much easier for a defense, and I'm sure TCU recognizes that.
Second down. Mahomes throws for Grant, who loses the football, and they say incomplete. Denzel Johnson broke it up, and you can see a noticeable limp for Mahomes.
Yeah, Mahomes is just going to be struggling a bit the rest of this game because TCU is too good at trying to get the move the quarterback off the spot. They've had two sacks a game for quite some time now. Third and long, not necessarily where you want to be, in particular if you can't move your feet and get outside the pocket.
Only the third down they've faced today. Mahomes under pressure, throws it up for grabs, and incomplete. Should have been picked off by Montrell Wilson with Curry and Pearson applying the pressure.
It almost looked like a team meeting back there for TCU. Pearson and Caraway able to get in the backfield pretty quickly, and Mahomes again not able to do much. That pocket's just suffocating out around him. And when you're playing the number three team in the country, turnovers are the biggest factor in determining the wins and losses. So you can't be throwing the ball up like that. There's worse things than taking a sack.
You mentioned the improvement in penalties this year for Texas Tech. The other improvement has been in the turnover margin. Here's Gavonte Turpin dancing his way close to the 40. 53-yard punt with a 15-yard return, and Trevon Boykin, Heisman candidate, off to a good start in this game. Back to the field with his team trailing when you come by. Here's our KFC stat comparison, taking a look at the quarterbacks. More than half of Boykin's completions have gone to Josh Dotson. One of the staples for them this year has been spreading the ball around, but not today.
No, not today. Colby Lissenby is out. Sometimes as a quarterback, you might not feel quite as comfortable with a guy like Emmanuel Porter. The coaches are confident in him, but you haven't had quite as many reps, and especially in a game scenario. Five of those seven catches for Dotson have either been for a first down or a touchdown.
How about back-to-back punts where these two offensive powerhouses? This drive starting at the 39, and they go right back to Dotson. He's unable to make the first man miss. Tackle made by Paul Banks, who's seeing more time than he has at any point this year.
And defensive coordinator David Gibbs said, we got to make the easy tackles in space, because once these wide receivers for TCU get going, that's when it's hard to tackle them downfield. So you got to be able to make the tackles when you got them. Paul Banks did a nice job of getting Dotson down to the ground.
There is Coach Gibbs, the seventh defensive coordinator in the last 7 years at Texas Tech. Previously at Houston, spent a lot of time in the NFL. Quite a personality.
He's with Doug Meacham at actually Houston University.
Yeah.
He knows this offense well.
The co-offensive coordinators for TCU. Here comes pressure. They try to gash it with a run and do. It's Aaron Green inside the 25 with a TCU first down on a pickup of 32.
Texas Tech has struggled against the run this year, giving up on average 257 yards a game. And it's in part because they don't hold their gaps. They allow seams in their defense, and a good offensive team's going to find those.
They go back to Green, who's shut down by Micah Awe. Now, prior to that long run from Green, Texas Tech's run defense had been pretty solid.
Yeah, but look, these offenses are going to get so many plays and so many touches throughout the course of the game. It's tough to be able to limit them to so many yards, but you try to do your best. So what becomes pivotal is turnovers and red zone defense. So Texas Tech is going to look to try to be stout here against the run and shut down any big plays on the outside.
Remember the last time TCU moved it down to this end of the field, they forced a field goal and blocked it. Second down and 10 from the 24. Boykin fakes to Buck Jones and throws to the end zone over the head of Jarrison Stewart, and incomplete.
Part of the problem on that play is it was a jet sweep fake to Buck Jones, their tight
end. That's not fooling anybody.
That's not fooling anyone. Well, you're going to see Jarrison Stewart, number 14, running up the sideline on a wheel route. TCU trying to find the soft spot in that zone coverage for Texas Tech, unable to complete it.
In a bit of a trend now. TCU moving the ball in the middle part of the field, but running into some issues down inside the 25. Against a four-man rush, Boykin well protected. Tipped in the air, incomplete. Gift wrap for Justice Nelson, who couldn't hang on, and it's fourth down.
Texas Tech is playing a cover two zone coverage, meaning you got two guys for the deep halves of the field, and everyone underneath is playing zone coverage. They're forcing TCU to try to work the ball to the middle of the field. And right now, Texas Tech's defense doing a nice job of reading the eyes of Trevon Boykin. That time should have been a pick, but Banks, as well as Gaines, in to break up the pass. Nelson needs to bring that in.
Those are the kinds of plays they've been making so far this year. Top 10 in the country in takeaways. Obercrome had his last one blocked. He nails this one from 42. That brings TCU back to within two. Couple of 3-0 teams in the Big 12 opener. It's been a good one so far. Fox College Football is sponsored by Xbox One, the official game console of the NFL. By State Farm, it pays to double check. Talk to your agent today. And by DraftKings, free one-week fantasy football at DraftKings.com. Back at Jones AT&T Stadium, Texas Tech trying to pull the upset. And so far, this defense doing a pretty good job against a great offense under first-year D coordinator David Gibbs.
David Gibbs trying to lay down a foundation, something that Texas Tech has not been able to do since really 2009 with all the changes. They kept on Mike Smith as co-defensive coordinator and D-line coach, a former Red Raider. So they're really trying to build upon what they've had so far this season. And it's been rough at times, but look, they're getting turnovers, and they're doing enough to win.
They're trying to pull another upset over a top five team here in Lubbock. You go back to 2002, late November, welcomed in the number four team in the country, Texas. Beat them by four. A couple of years later, number three, Oklahoma, went down 34-27. One of the more memorable games in recent college football history was that 39-33 win against top-ranked Texas. And then in 2012, they crushed number five West Virginia. This is a tough, tough place to come play.
Now, TCU struggled here. 0 for 4 in their last four trips. Not an easy place.
Got to go back to 91 to find the last time TCU won in Lubbock. First down carry for DeAndre Washington, who has a touchdown run today. Stopped by Traven Howard. Second down and six.
Justin Stockton, number four, has come in the game, and he adds a different element in this run attack for Texas Tech. A lot of speed.
He's lined up to the right of Mahomes, who fakes to Washington and sets up deep in the pocket. Feeds it to Washington, who's close to a Texas Tech first down. Tackle made by Denzel Johnson. It is enough to move the chains.
It's a great 1-2 punch. They have DeAndre Washington, who's all-around running back, and Justin Stockton comes in and brings in blazing speed and big play ability.
Stockton lines up outside, and they go to Washington straight ahead. Bounced off initial contact, pulled down by Howard along with Michael Downing. Second down.
Curious to see Patrick Mahomes if he gets involved in the run game again. That knee looks like it's still bothering him, and that makes it that much easier on the TCU defense if he's not capable of getting outside the pocket or running in their zone read scheme.
Yeah, his running ability is a differentiator this year for Texas Tech from previous seasons here. Ian Sadler with his first reception and a first down close to midfield. Hit out of bounds by Derek Kindred. Sadler's a guy that you like.
I love Sadler. I mean, he runs great routes, has solid hands. He's Patrick Mahomes' roommate, so believe me, they have a connection as well. And you can tell when you watch this team. He's who he relies on a lot to make those tough catches across the middle.
Stockton back in there at running back. We've not seen him flash yet today. He takes the fake. Quick throw, Jakeem Grant. Makes Downey miss. And close to a first down. Pushed out by Montrell Wilson. Right at the sticks.
He's just so much fun to watch. He's like a human joystick.
Yeah.
He just moves around. He's so tough to touch, and even in a phone booth.
5'6", 170.
Yeah.
Ah! Texas Tech has it moving. Here's Stockton, thrown down by Carraway. First time we've seen Stockton get his hands on it. Boy, is he electric.
He really is. It was a play last week where he looked like he was shot out of a cannon versus Arkansas for a touchdown.
Tech picking up the tempo again. Mahomes all kinds of time. And we'll throw this one away. It will be third down.
TCU thought he maybe wasn't outside the pocket, but it looks like he broke contain initially. He was able to get rid of the football, but Mahomes
there is
not
foul
moving
for intentional
the same.
Grounding.
Alfredo Morales lost his helmet. Coming off, it looks like in pain. He's not the same guy right now.
No, he's not. I mean, right here, Mahomes would usually find a way to slip outside the pocket. Davion Pearson with possibly a late hit, but Alfredo Morales played 33 games in his career here at Texas Tech. It's a big loss up front. That left side has been very effective so far in running the football.
Four to choose from into the wide side of the field for Mahomes. Directing traffic, throws back across the field, and Batson is pulled down for a loss by Montrell Wilson. So it'll be fourth down for Texas Tech.
There are times and there are plays that Patrick Mahomes makes that make you just go, did he just do that?
Yeah.
Scrambling all the way to his left, flipping around and finding Cameron Batson, the short right side of the field. He had an option pitch last week where he actually went up and blocked after he pitched the football.
I think they prefer that he didn't do that anymore. They will go for it on fourth down. And we saw TCU line up in a similar field position and punt with Trevon Boykin earlier in this game. This is a legitimate attempt on fourth down. Deep ball for Davis. Incomplete. And no flags. Underthrown. Looks like he had a step on O'Mealy. But Mahomes underthrew it and a turnover on downs.
Yeah, the key play there for O'Mealy was once he got back into phase, meaning once he closed the gap on Davis, he was able to get his head around just in the last second. So that right there kind of negates really any contact he makes just by turning around for that split second to try to find the football, using all parts of his body to get the PBU there.
That drive had some promise, but it dies at the 38. TCU's back on the field. Inside of 7 minutes in this first half, down two. Boykin in rhythm, pulled in by Emmanuel Porter. And Porter is hurt.
Injury timeout.
Man, I've never seen anything like this with the poor luck TCU is having with injuries this year.
It's unbelievable. This team's absolutely snake bitten. Oof.
And Porter only in the game because Colby Lissenby is banged up. Back in a moment. You know, the injury story has mostly been told on defense for TCU, but we're seeing it attack the offense now today.
Yeah, and Emmanuel Porter, after making a nice grab, used every bit of that 6'4 frame to reach up and get the football. But as he came down, as if Tevin Madison just kind of got him right there on the knee might have hyperextended a little bit.
There's a guy he's in for, Colby Lissenby, who we've not seen play today. Was limited in practice this week and hasn't taken the field yet today. Here's a speed option. Boykin spinning off contact and going down. Malik Jenkins with a tackle for loss. And it's second and 11.
Yeah, and credit number 9, Brandon Jackson, really disrupting this play. Once he penetrated through the line of scrimmage, he got Boykin to stop his feet. Very key.
TCU's in a hurry. Boykin throws it high, tipped and incomplete. In and out of the hands of Aaron Green.
This TCU offense is so out of sync right now. They've been playing much slower than usual as far as getting up to the line of scrimmage. In that case, then they try to speed things up, and it just doesn't seem like Boykin can get into a rhythm where he looks comfortable back there in the pocket.
Third down and 11.
The Texas Tech, just keep doing what you're doing. Try to get pressure at those front four and contain Boykin and play good zone coverage on the back end.
They rush only four. Boykin steps into a deep ball into one-on-one coverage. Dotson pulls it in. Touchdown TCU from 52 yards on third and long.
Well, that goes a little bit into the inexperience of Paul Banks. Defensive coordinator David Gibbs talked a little bit about Trevon Boykin throwing balls that usually most quarterbacks won't throw. He waits a little bit longer to get out of his hands, and the DBs have to cover for that much longer. It's incredibly difficult. He knew it. Eventually, they would give up some big plays at some point.
Nine catches for 152 yards and now two touchdowns for Dotson. And TCU's back in front. You mentioned the big plays. There's one of them there. Throwing it up for Dotson, who beat Banks. The number three Horned Frogs trying to extend the nation's second longest winning streak in front by five. Second touchdown of the day for Josh Dotson. Big time afternoon for the senior from Mansfield, Texas, who started his career at Wyoming, transferred in, and has become Trevon Boykin's favorite target. That one into the end zone, and Texas Tech takes a touchback.
Let's go back and look at this most recent touchdown. Josh Dotson's at the top of your screen, matched up on number 28, Paul Banks. And watch Trevon Boykin in the pocket. No one's able to get pressure for Texas Tech, and he's able to just sit back there and take his time. And eventually throws it up. Paul Banks in position, but Dotson just able to make the play. It's so difficult when you have to go versus this TCU offense. You've got to be able to cover for a long, long time against one of the better wide receivers in college football.
See what kind of response Texas Tech has. They begin with play action. Mahomes, a confident throw to the outside. That is incomplete. Wanted Lauderdale. And in front of that TCU sideline, the officials got plenty of help making the call. Second and 10.
And one of the keys for Texas Tech to be able to start moving the ball again is having more production on first down. They've been struggling a little bit as far as getting things going on first down and putting themselves then in third and long.
On second down, and Washington tripped up by Downing out of his safety spot after 9 yards, setting up a third and one.
And if Michael Downing doesn't get Washington to the ground, he might be taking that to the house.
Now quickly, Texas Tech is back in the ball with another run play up the gut. And Washington with a first down to the 40. Stop made by Howard.
That's what makes DeAndre Washington so special. His change of direction, his ability to start and stop in an instance.
Fake it to him here. They pump short. Deep ball for Davis. Overthrown again, beating O'Mealy. Now the first time he had beaten him, it was underthrown, and now too much on it.
He'd been taking a hit too at the end of the throw. Couldn't exactly finish probably the way he would have liked. Holmes is a tough player though. You know, more than anything else, he wants to be out here and he wants to be competing and see if he can pull off another monumental upset here in Lubbock.
Second down and 10. He seemingly hurt that leg in one of the early drives, but Chris Budden reporting that he told the trainers he's fine and he stayed in despite a noticeable limp. And throws this one into a tiny window for Ian Sadler, who comes up clutching that left leg.
Injury timeout.
Well, Mahomes checks to this concept. You can just see Sadler wait for a moment and then adjust. Makes a great catch coming back to the football, which is key in order to beat the defender to the ball. He bangs up the knee as he comes to the ground, but still maintains possession of the football.
It's a second catch for Sadler in this second quarter, and he's helped off of the field.
And a big play by Mahomes. Really the first time we've seen him be able to move outside the pocket and make a play like that.
So the training staff will take a look at the sophomore Sadler, While his roommate Mahomes tries to continue this drive for Texas Tech. Press set of downs from the 46. Here's Washington. Inside the 30 with another first down run. This one for 19 yards.
One of the biggest keys as a running back is being able to press the line of scrimmage, meaning starting downhill, and then once you get the defenders to suck up into the line of scrimmage, you can bounce it outside. And DeAndre Washington has the speed and ability to do that.
Really turned himself into a good all-around player and having a good day today. Up to 82 yards in his first half. We'll add to that total here. Another first down run and nearing 100 in his first half.
Number 37, Quinn White came into the game. He's essentially their fullback.
Injury timeout.
You're going to see him lay a block that helps open up this jump cut by DeAndre Washington. Washington has the speed to do the rest.
And now Josh Caraway is down, holding his left leg. TCU already down seven of its initial starters on this defense. Already down three defensive ends. Caraway, one of the only guys they planned on starting that's still around.
Yeah, and he's a heck of a player. Had a great game last week versus SMU. Six tackles, 2.5 sacks, 3 tackles for loss. So again, another key defensive player down for TCU. And with all these lower body extremity injuries, you got to attribute it to something.
Yeah.
And all I can think of is the footwear has gotten lighter, less durable, less stable. And eventually that's going to have, or it's going to cause an issue. Not only for your foot and ankle, but knees, hips, all that. Because all the force that's provided into the ground as it comes up through the body, I mean, if you don't put it down in a proper form, that shoe is not durable enough to really be stable in those joints.
It seems like it's got to be something more than coincidence, because it's happening everywhere at an alarming rate, it seems, this year, higher than normal. On first down, they get it to Reggie Davis. And the block on the outside, unable to be connected on. And Nick Orr came up to make the tackle. They lose a yard, and it's second down.
True freshman Jonathan Giles trying to fight his way on that block, but it's one of the keys for these Texas Tech wide receivers. They have to become better blockers for their teammates before they can really get on the field and get more touches with the football.
It's a rare long sustained drive for Texas Tech. Normally you see them striking quickly. Here's the ninth play, and it's got Mahomes over the middle and incomplete. Couple of dropped interceptions today from both sides. This one, Traven Howard, and it's third down.
They like to utilize their slot wide receiver matched up one-on-one with all that space. But again, Giles not able to bring the football in. Freshman struggling early.
Third down and 12. Draw play for Washington, who's got a hole, and DeAndre Washington makes it a decision right here for Cliff Kingsbury. It's fourth down and a short two.
It looks like they're going to speed things up and go for it. You got to love the aggressiveness of Cliff Kingsbury.
He runs all the way down to watch the play from up close, and Mahomes limps his way into the end zone for the Texas Tech touchdown.
Yeah, the only one left at home to be able to tackle Patrick Mahomes was number 26, Derek Kindred. But as much as he's handed the football off, Patrick Mahomes had a clear path to the end zone, scoots on in.
Yeah, you didn't need fresh legs to get in there.
Yeah, I think we both might have been able to run that one in.
So Mahomes has Texas Tech back in front. And Clayton Hatfield on for the extra point. Out of the hold of Cameron Batson, knocks it through. Good response by Mahomes, and the fourth down gamble pays off. Cliff Kingsbury ran down to the 10-yard line to watch this one up close, and he liked what he saw. Mahomes in for the score. The Red Raiders back in front. Fox College Football is presented by Geico, and Patrick Mahomes on fourth down and two, untouched into the end zone.
Yeah, it's pretty effective anytime you've got a quarterback who can run the ball into the end zone, in particular down in the red zone. Mahomes a little bit banged up today, but still being able to do the job. Fast play helps that, puts more pressure on the defense.
What a weapon Samanke is with those long, good hang time kicks. And Turpin has to take a knee as we check in with Rob Stone in Los Angeles.
All right, Joe, thanks. Coming up on the State Farm Halftime, Leonard Fournette continued his Heisman campaign by doing something no SEC player has done since 1998. Plus the sights from a tight Oklahoma State-Texas battle and Baylor testing the scoreboard's capacity. Back to you guys in Lubbock.
All right, Rob, while much of the Big 12 is starting conference play, Baylor taking on Rice today.
Yeah, I was just talking about Leonard Fournette really kind of making his way and staking his claim on that Heisman campaign early in the season. 26 carries, 244 yards, two touchdowns. It's a heck of a day.
Heck of a day for these offenses. You saw there were over 600 yards of total offense combined. Final minutes of this opening half, and Trevon Boykin against a three-man rush. Gary Moore got pressure, able to get it away and dump it off. And it's Hicks for a first down across the 40.
And number five, Gary Moore, had an opportunity. This is what defensive coordinator David Gibbs talked about. When you have the easy tackles, you got to be able to make them. Now, it's never really easy trying to tackle Trevon Boykin, but you're not going to get a better shot than him dropping back in the pocket.
Yeah, it's all relative, right? How about that play against SMU he made last week?
Unbelievable.
Loading pressure and getting in for a touchdown run. No doubt he'll be on the Heisman reel as he makes his campaign here in his senior season. He tucks it again, takes off this time, and navigates his way for seven.
Yeah, they added a spy, number 40, Dakota Allen, waiting for him. I think Texas Tech is just hoping they can try to contain him, not allow him to have one of those big runs like he had a week ago at SMU. He'll avoid a rush and then scamper for about 30-some yards into the end zone.
As a sophomore against Texas Tech a couple of years ago, he ran for 100. He's had some big games in his career against the Red Raiders, including that one last year with the seven touchdown passes. On second and three, Aaron Green able to submarine close to a first down. Wasn't much room there, but what room there was, he found his way through.
TCU finds themselves in third and short. Again, a part of the field where you could see them going for it on fourth down if they don't get it.
Boykin has a first down. I think a lot of the crowd was fooled and started to cheer when Green got swallowed up, but it was Boykin carrying for four and a TCU first down.
Yeah, number 15, Keenan Ward came down from the secondary to try to contain Boykin. Was able to wrap him up, but unfortunately, Boykin too good for the first down. Keeps the drive alive.
Ward, a former quarterback himself. In fact, had never even played defense before he arrived at Texas Tech. Become a solid player on the back end for the Red Raiders. Inside of a minute and a half now in this opening half. Boykin double clutches, takes off, and goes down across the 40, tripped up by Micah Awe with a flag down in the backfield.
Looks like it's going to be a holding on the TCU offensive line.
Holding offense, number 74, 10 yards from the previous spot. First down.
That Texas Tech D-line doing a pretty good job putting pressure on another injured player.
Big number 74, Big V, struggling against Pete Robertson today. Robertson, excuse me. He struggled against Robertson, Jackson. They've all been giving Big V some trouble.
And hard from this angle to see who the injured Texas Tech player is. And it is Gary Moore. Good to see him to his feet. Looks like leaning towards that shoulder.
Yeah.
Some upper body pain.
He's got that size and ability you really want in that rush end. a guy who mixes in very well with Brandon Jackson coming off that edge. So a loss that Texas Tech really can't deal with, saying they don't have a ton of depth on the outside rushing the passer.
Yeah, David Gibbs told us yesterday this is Gary Moore's kind of game. With a spread offense, TCU runs. First down and long, and they'll lose yards. Penetration from Rika Levy, the 340-pound senior, dropping green for a loss.
And Levy was able to just win with lower pad level, a little quickness off the ball. The big guy, 333 pounds.
Inside of a minute left in this first half. Texas Tech by two. Back in a moment. State Farm halftime is coming up. We've seen points like we expected, maybe not to the degree we expected. And part of that is that these teams, known for their up-tempo offenses, have slowed it down some.
Yeah, a lot of people out there thought this was going to be a very high-scoring game. When talking with the coaches this week, they kind of thought maybe not so much, in particular TCU. And what we're seeing right now is a little bit of a cat-and-mouse game between two staffs who know each other very well.
They reset the clock to 50 seconds. Right after we went to break, second down and 23. Boykin feels the pressure, moves in the pocket, throws high, looking for Nixon with a coverage from Nelson. And it's third down and long.
There's one thing Trevon Boykin needs to work on. It's having a better feel and ability to sit in the pocket and anticipate, get the ball out of his hands sometimes. When he struggles, it's when he's actually just got to sit in the pocket and make throws. That was the case a little bit last year, in particular versus West Virginia, but even though they were able to get a win. So far in this game, that's where I see like they've struggled a little bit passing the football.
Yeah, he's shown his ability to throw it deep. You see him in the quick game, but like you said, those intermediate throws, something he's still working on. Only three rush, shows off the arm strength and picks up the first down. Who else? Josh Dotson beating Justice Nelson for 27 yards.
And an absolute laser from Trevon Boykin into the hole in the zone coverage. Justice Nelson's got to get back further. He had no threat in the flat, really no reason not to sink back underneath Dotson.
Two timeouts left for TCU. First down at the Texas Tech 31. Boykin steps into his throw again. First down again. Inside the 10 goes Jarrison Stewart, who's replaced Tyce Lanina, one of the inside receiver spots. First down and goal for the Frogs.
It's called cause and effect. You work to Dotson, you work to Dotson. It opens up that ball across the middle.
And he'll spike it to stop the clock at 26 seconds. Still two timeouts and second and goal now.
As fast as this TCU offense can run, there's no doubt this is a long time for them with two timeouts and their ability to throw the ball in the end zone. And a guy I'm going to be looking for is Josh Dotson. If not, Juwan Story is another guy who's got that big body and frame that can really elevate and get the football.
Well, you'd think Texas Tech would be looking for Josh Dotson as well. 10 catches for 179 yards in this first half. And another quick timeout. We'll be back in 30 seconds. 26 seconds, two timeouts, whole playbook at your disposal.
Yeah, in particular the running game and Trevon Boykin becoming even more of a threat in the running game. In particular, if they try to double coverage Josh Dotson, anyone else for the TCU, for their wide receivers on the outside.
Dotson lined up to the top of your screen. Second down and goal for the Horned Frogs. Here is a quarterback run. Boykin unable to turn the corner. Angled out of bounds at the five. You got 20 seconds and two timeouts, but now it's third down.
Yeah, and in this case, I think looking at the score the way it is, you want to be a little bit more conservative. You could still run the football with a timeout. Or you could try to take a shot at Josh Dotson, although they tried to double him that last snap. So they actually have the advantage to run the football if they want it.
Dotson again all the way to the top of the screen. Once you see from this angle here, working against Justice Nelson. Boykin into the end zone and a dart for a touchdown. Dotson worked the back of the end zone and he's got his third touchdown of this first half.
And that was all possible because of Trevon Boykin and his eyes. This is a little motion out to the bottom of the field. Boykin looks off the entire defense and just waits for Josh Dotson to find that hole in the zone coverage. This is the exact same play they used earlier for Dotson's first touchdown.
And he's now within one touchdown of the score record set by Josh Boyce, whose 21st touchdown reception in a TCU uniform. Boykin to Dotson, Boykin to Dotson, Boykin to Dotson, three times in this first half. It's a big time throw, big time play there for TCU on third down.
Yeah, when you play at such a fast pace, sometimes it gets hard for you to be patient and for you to take a breath back there and wait for things to open up. I think that's one of the hardest things about playing in these fast-paced spread offenses.
They get tough down there in the red zone, too. Those windows get tighter. He was able to find one. And a touchback. October coming up, and it means baseball. FS1 continues to be your home for postseason action, the American League Division and Championship Series. Don't miss a moment of the drama in history, all beginning October 8th on FS1, streaming live on Fox Sports Go. 15 seconds, couple of timeouts. You give it a try at all?
You know, before half, I would kneel it. I would always try to hand the football off with a running play, because then you accomplish the same thing, and you at least give yourself the chance to break a run for a touchdown.
And the argument the other way would be you also risk fumbling.
You risk fumbling the snap as well.
Yeah.
At the end of the game, it's one thing. But at halftime, why not take the opportunity to just run a running play? DeAndre Washington's a home run hitter. He's got the ability. And if he doesn't, clock runs out.
First half, this sees four lead changes and one ties. We go down to Chris Button.
Coach, at times we've seen your defense be able to make Trayvon Boykin look very uncomfortable. What do you need to do to continue to limit him second half?
Yeah, not uncomfortable enough. Really, our offense has squandered a bunch of drives. You know, you got to take advantage of the drives you have. We haven't played very well.
We've seen Patrick Mahomes take some hits, not look 100%. How does his health affect your play calling?
A little bit, but he's a tough kid. He's hanging in there.
I appreciate it. Good luck in the second half. Joe?
All right, Chris. Yeah, Mahomes banged up early in the game and clearly hampered as that first half went on. Good one going here. We go to Los Angeles with Rob Stone. Washington in. Touchdown, Texas Tech. All day to throw. Over the top, Jakeem Grant. Touchdown, Texas Tech. Promptly taking advantage of a mental miscue from TCU. Boykin into the end zone and a dart for a touchdown. Dotson worked the back of the end zone and he's got his third touchdown of this first half. It has been as advertised as we welcome you back to Fox College Football presented by Geico. A lot of yards, a lot of points. A lot of fun so far. 33-28 TCU in this matchup of 3-0 teams in this Big 12 opener. We welcome you back inside. Joe Davis, Brady Quinn. I think it's about what we expected so far as these offenses producing.
It's been all about the big plays, and we thought this coming into the game based on how explosive these two offenses were and really how bad each defense has struggled so far this year. But for TCU, it's been all Josh Dotson. You might as well call this guy Superman the way he's played so far in the first half. He's got to be a guy leading for the Biletnikoff, which is the best wide receiver in the country. He's their deep ball threat. He's a guy in critical situations they work to for first downs. And for Texas Tech, it's been Jakeem Grant and Devin Lauderdale. Those have been the guys that have really provided the majority of the production and big plays. And I'm sure we're going to see more here in the second half, Joe.
We had in that first half more than 700 yards of offense. The team's averaged 7.5 yards per play. So we take a look at the rest of the stats. You know, we talked about TCU slowing things down, not being as fast as they normally are. They ran 56 plays in that first half.
Well, but they were slower than Texas Tech. Texas Tech was running a play every 16 seconds. TCU at 20 seconds per play, so a little bit closer. TCU is usually around that 16-second mark.
That one buried through the back of the end zone. TCU will start at the 25 as we go down to Chris Button.
I talked to Gary Patterson. He says this game is playing out exactly like they thought it was. He's happy with his team's offense. He says we need to try and stay out of third and long. On defense, he says it still comes down to tackling. We have to tackle better. He says, I still think this is going to come down to the last team that has the football. A couple other injury notes quick for you guys. Tyson Lanina is out for the rest of the game. Josh Caraway, the good news, he was just some cramps in his calf.
Wow. So for once, good news for TCU in the injury front.
Surprising. They get IVs before the game. TCU does. So surprising he's cramping up.
Today with the temperature is in the low 80s, high 70s. From the 25, they start this second half with an Aaron Green run, and he picks his way for a pickup of close to 10, pulled down by Dakota Allen. As we look at our leaders on offense in that first half, you saw Green run for 9 there to add to this total. Quickly back in the ball, and that swing pass is incomplete, third down.
Yeah, you look at the offensive leaders for TCU, and really it's been kind of like we thought. Aaron Green in the running game. Boykin's been pretty efficient in the passing game, working to Josh Dotson with Colby Listen be out. Emmanuel Porter as well, number one. He got hurt earlier in this game. It was in replace of Listen B, so they're getting a little bit thin at wide receiver. We'll see the adjustments for the Texas Tech defense after halftime.
Well, TCU in that first half, 8 of 12 on third down. And on third and short, it's Boykin keeping for a first down. Several times during that first half, he was able to move the chains with his legs and does so here on the first drive of the second.
And that's the tough part, is you got to pick your poison versus this TCU offense. You want to try to double coverage someone on the outside or try to protect the big play versus Josh Dotson. TCU is then going to have a favorable box count or run blocking scheme. So it allows the running game for TCU to get an advantage.
Fresh set of downs from the 39 off play action. Boykin off his back foot, still able to get rid of it, but incomplete. Looking for Jarrison Stewart. Micah Awe with the coverage, and it's second and 10.
Dakota Allen there getting to Boykin at the end of his throw. It just seems like this Texas Tech defense has been doing a good job of making Boykin feel a little bit uncomfortable in the pocket, not able to make those throws around the middle of the field.
And that's the level of throws that he's not shown consistently he's great at. We've seen him really good on the deep ball. We've seen him good underneath. His intermediate throws continue to be a spot where he's got to improve. On second and 10, it's Green. He hesitates and accelerates, making a cut for a first down. That's a heck of a run from Aaron Green.
Joe, you said it. He hesitated. And what happened was Texas Tech is a fast-flowing defense to the football, but sometimes you can overrun the ball and allowed Aaron Green to hesitate, make the cutback, and get upfield.
And he actually didn't have a first down, I beg your pardon. They spotted him well short, so TCU quickly on the ball, and that was just a play ahead of him.
Foreshadowing what was
that's
to
what it
occur.
Was. Yep. I think. Yeah, it's a first down. They'll set the chains. Opening drive, second half. The Heisman hopeful, Trevon Boykin and the number 3 Horned Frogs trying to extend the nation's second longest winning streak to 12 games dating back to last year. And that loss down in Waco. From midfield, Boykin steps into the pocket and throws a strike for a first down. Desmond White was so good in the opener at Minnesota, but he's dealt with a turf toe problem since. This is the biggest role we've seen him play since week one today.
Yeah, and he was a little bit beat up in that game. Minnesota was pretty physical versus TCU, so he just now started becoming fresh again.
Back to him here. Makes a juke. And they tried to rip that ball out, which we've seen become the personality of this Texas Tech defense this year.
They were pulling out that ball. They almost took Desmond White with it.
Yeah.
He's only 150 pounds or so. He's tiny, but boy, is he tough to bring down. Very elusive in the open field.
Listed at 150, so what is he actually?
Who knows?
Yeah, probably not 150.
He might have been weighing in with a couple extra pounds there.
Second down and 2. Low snap, pulled up. Boykin scans the field, looking for Dotson, who doesn't pull it in, and it's almost a surprise now when he doesn't make a circus catch, defended by Madison, and it's third and short.
I'm just shocked at this point how Texas Tech has not devoted more attention to Josh Dotson. He was open in the corner of the end zone. Madison was able to get over there just in the nick of time, but if Josh Dotson gets his hands on it, he comes down. That's a touchdown.
Madison gave that stare down like sweet play I just made. He was wide open.
Well, and don't be surprised if they don't come back to that matchup in the bottom of your screen.
On third down and two.
Quarterback sneak though. Oh, nope.
They'll turn and hand to Green, who fights through the tackle of Malik Jenkins for a first down.
It's the first time I've ever seen TCU actually run the ball with Trevon Boykin under center.
Right, other than a quarterback
sneak. Yeah.
Green continues to impress. TCU continues to rack up the yardage. And 500 total yards for the Horned Frogs. On first down, speed option. Green. Chopped down, Micah Awe, team captain in the middle linebacker spot with his team leading eighth tackle. Second down coming up.
A great play by Micah Awe. Did a nice job of avoiding the left tackle, climbing up. Tried to reach, block him. Able to get to the football. Micah Awe is always around the football because he does a nice job of running and really sniffing things out in the run game.
Second and eight, Texas Tech shows edge pressure and brings it. Boykin just gets rid of it, and it's a strike inside the 10. First down and goal as Jarrison Stewart gets his third catch of the day. Boykin took a shot there.
Yeah, and that's the risk-reward. Texas Tech brought pressure there, but then you've got one-on-one coverage with Jarrison Stewart on Jayshon Johnson. Boykin hanging tough. Pete Robertson, another hit on Trevon Boykin. Those hits are going to add up throughout the course of the game.
And throughout the course of the season, for a guy that they've continued to preach to, avoid it all you can, as valuable of a player as there is in college football. Sidearms to Dotson. Good open field tackle that time from Justice Nelson. Those are the ones you've been talking about. David Gibbs said they've got to make.
Yeah, and you've got to stop a guy like Josh Dotson before he gets going, because once he gets going, he's tough to bring down. He's got about a 30-pound advantage on Justice Nelson. TCU brought in their power formation set. This is usually where they like to pound the football and run the football.
And the power formation for them involves really a tight end lining up at fullback, Dominic Merka. Play action, Dotson over the middle. Jawan Story held on for the TCU touchdown, says one judge. And then another official overrules him and says incomplete. Third down and goal.
We talked about TCU bringing in their power running group to utilize their run action pass. Juwan Story catches the football, gets down, and it comes out there at the very end. As Story comes to the ground, doesn't maintain possession. He's got to make sure he keeps his body in between the football and the ground. They had it. It was open.
Yeah.
Good design, good play call by offensive coordinator Sonny Cumbie and co-offensive coordinator Doug Meacham.
You'll see the back judge here throw his hands up. I promise you he did. And then one of the other officials came in and said no.
Talk about Sonny Cumbie, and we'll talk about him here in a moment.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Incomplete pass.
We talked about Sonny Cumbie and meeting with him. You could see the kind of smile on his face and talking about the different places to go to eat and whatnot in Lubbock. He's very familiar with this city and this town based on all the success he had as a quarterback here. You better believe he was excited about having an opportunity to come back in and get a win, something they haven't been able to do in quite some time.
I think Chris Button mentioned a restaurant she saw by our hotel, and he knew automatically what hotel we were at when she mentioned the restaurant. So after that ball that was broken up and confirmed, third down and goal for TCU. Tech brings heat. Picked up. Thrown high. Fourth down. Deshaun Johnson with the coverage as it sails over the head of Jerison Stewart. Field goal team comes out.
Yeah, well, they're going to bring pressure, and you've just got man-to-man coverage on the outside. Texas Tech taking a gamble. Trevon Boykin not able to convert. Jerison Stewart got a little tied up with Deshaun Johnson, but overall good coverage and the pressure getting home quick enough to not allow the touchdown.
Oberkrom today, good from 42. Had one blocked from 36. This from 25. Oh, my goodness. One of the top kickers in the nation misses from point blank. .62 made field goals in his career, more than any player in the country. But off of the right hash, which is an angle that right-footed kickers normally like, he misses wide right. Fox College Football is sponsored by Infiniti, luxury cars that deliver inspired performance. Colonel Sanders, Kentucky Fried Chicken, it's still finger-licking good. And by New York Life, here to help you keep good going. Back in Lubbock, Jaden Oberkrom with a rare, tough day. And we mentioned special teams on paper being in TCU's favor coming in. He's had one blocked, and then he missed one from short range.
Yeah, and then you got the big return by Jakeem Grant for 51 yards as well. Advantage Texas Tech.
And so how does Texas Tech now respond? Taking over at the 20 with Pat Mahomes in this offense on their opening drive of half number two. DeAndre Washington had more than 100 yards in the first half. Short gain of two. The senior from Missouri City, Texas. And again, this offense has a reputation for being one that throws it all over the place. But that ground game has made this offense much different than the old Tech offenses.
Yeah, DeAndre Washington and Justin Stockton really allow for Texas Tech to have that balance and explosive plays from the running game.
Here's a deep ball. Lauderdale running behind O'Mealy. And the flag comes in late. They've gone after Corey O'Mealy time after time. And finally, he's got to interfere to make sure Lauderdale doesn't score.
Pass interference, defense number two, 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
And at the end of the play, you can see O'Mealy diving, trying to stop, prevent the touchdown, really whatever he could. Smart play by O'Mealy.
They've continued to go after him.
Yeah, he's, you know, the less experienced corner between him and number 18, Nick Orr.
First down, Washington, big hole off that right side. DeAndre Washington cuts it back inside the 20. 43 yards before Kindred made the stop.
And Texas Tech now going into hyperdrive. DeAndre Washington with the big play, and this is where Texas Tech likes to pour it on and put even more pressure on the defense.
Quickly back on the ball, Washington again. Somehow stays on his feet for a miraculous gain of five.
I don't know if anyone from the Texas Tech offensive line blocked anyone. It was as if DeAndre Washington found a way to slither through there. But even those sorts of plays tire out their own offensive line.
It's almost like they said, it's been too easy for you so far. See what you can do when nobody's blocked.
Yeah, that's why Justin Stockton's in the backfield now. Give Washington a break.
He's normally the big play threat. They give it to him. And Denzel Johnson, it's early this year, but number 30 in white, putting together an early case for an all-conference type season.
Yeah, and again, he's that key component in the TCU defense for Gary Patterson. He's a guy who is put into space a lot of times, has to be able to be good in coverage, but also in the run game, and he's got a lot of responsibilities on his plate, having to cover a lot of slot wide receivers.
Texas Tech has not converted a third down that's been longer than third and one today. Third and four here. Mahomes throwing in the quick game. It's a first down. It's Giles, the seldom used wide out, converting, setting up first down and goal, Texas Tech.
Yeah, Texas Tech loves to utilize their slot wide receivers. Those are the closest guys to the quarterback on third down. Easier completions, usually matched up with a lesser cover guy for the defense.
Stockton and Washington in the game here from the 9-yard line. First down and goal. Stockton slips a tackle, and Caraway pulls him down after four. And it's second down and goal. We've not seen them give the ball to Stockton straight ahead before today.
Yeah, and really, that's where he's best, is outside on the edge. We're running a lot of those jet sweeps. He's much more effective once he gets to the outside. He's a smaller back than DeAndre Washington, and it'd be nice to see him get it to him on the edge, allow him to utilize his speed.
Well, they line him up in the slot to the near side here, motioning into the backfield. He's got it. And again, running in between the tackles into the arms of Montrell Wilson. Interesting. Third goal.
We talked about it. They haven't converted anything better than third and one. So in this scenario, you can't keep trying to run the football. That's not working. You got to take a shot.
Stockton came off, and now you'll see him run into your screen. Back on the field for third down and goal. Mahomes clearly hurting. That was ugly. A flag comes out, and this drive will be extended. It's the second boneheaded play by the TCU defense today to extend a Texas Tech drive.
Yeah, again, Josh Caraway.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 94 of the defense. Half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
Just not a smart play. You just had a big third down stop, and all of a sudden, you're going to allow Texas Tech the opportunity to get back in this game and get the lead.
Remember the last time this happened, it was a roughing the passer penalty, and on the next play, Texas Tech hit him over the top for a touchdown.
Yeah. And I suspect they'll find a way of running this into the end zone. Now, Jakeem Grant wasn't on the field in that last third down, and you got to wonder, with a guy who's that special, how you don't have him on the field in a critical situation like that.
And he is not out there here on first and goal. Washington is. He makes the cut of the hole. Downhill. In. Touchdown, Texas Tech. Red Raiders back in front.
Texas Tech relying on the experience of this Tech offensive line to push the ball in. And again, DeAndre Washington presses the hole up the line of scrimmage and then jumps to the outside. Gets all the TCU defenders to suck up inside, and he finds the open hole into the end zone.
Hatfield's extra point hooks in, and it's 35-33 Texas Tech. DeAndre Washington set it all off with his long run. You see that C on his chest, a senior captain playing like it today. Tech was helped out by Caraway. The personal foul extended the drive. Washington was happy to take advantage and put the Red Raiders back up by two.
Welcome to Hooters, your fantasy football headquarters. You think you have what it takes to beat me? Enter the Hooters Fantasy Football Challenge for a shot of your share at 300 grand and a claim to fantasy football glory. You got to get into Hooters to find out how to win.
Fox College Football presented by Geico is sponsored by Bud Light. Stay in the game and drink responsibly. Back here at Jones AT&T Stadium. Texas Tech looking for its fourth top five win in this stadium in the last decade, and a chance today, believe it or not, already to match last year's win total. 4-8. First time they'd lost eight games in 33 years. Had to go back to the 1981 season. Find the last time they lost that many. Quick turnaround for Cliff Kingsbury, his Red Raider program. Of course, TCU was 4-8 2 years ago and followed that up with a 12-1 season last year. Well, it was the second penalty after the play on Josh Caraway that opened the door for the touchdown, and Gary Patterson letting him have it.
Yeah, DeMonte Cross, the co-defensive coordinator, talked to him as well. Patterson seems to be a little bit more animated. Not nice things to say, and Texas Tech able to convert 14 points off of mistakes from Caraway. on the road in Lubbock. Those are the sorts of things that'll get you beat.
The penalties have been an issue this season for TCU. Today, only three penalties, but two of them absolutely critical. Boykin back to work from the 25. Sets his feet, throws high, and Desmond White almost makes a circus catch. A 5'7", 150-pounder, not able to pull it in.
As a quarterback, when you're sitting back, going against that zone coverage, all the defense is watching your eyes. If you're not exactly comfortable with what you're seeing out there, which it doesn't look like Boykin is, it's going to play a part in your accuracy struggling a bit. A lot tighter windows to throw into than Boykin's used to.
Another one of those intermediate throws. Second down. Straight ahead is Green with a ton of room for a first down.
And that's how you counteract a soft zone coverage. As we see a Texas Tech player go down, looks like Jashawn Johnson. But that's how you counteract that soft zone coverage. You run the football because you have the advantage in the blocking scheme. There's not quite as many defenders in and around the line of scrimmage to stop the run.
That's a conundrum, right? You don't want to get beat over the top against a team that has as many playmakers as TCU, but then it exposes you to that.
Yeah, and some people define that as a bend but don't break defense. Keep everything in front of you, and eventually the offense will throw you something. And that's what defensive coordinator David Gibbs is hoping for.
TCU's over 500 yards of offense. First down at its own 36. Boykin scans the field and finds Dotson, who's got it close to a first down. He's, by the way, the first TCU receiver to have 10 catches in a game since Trevon Boykin 2 years ago, and he was playing receiver. And this feels like every play we're seeing somebody down for one of these teams, this time Tevin Madison.
Joe, this is an instance of what we call friendly fire. Pete Robertson on the outside playing zone coverage. He's going to run right into Tevin Madison.
If you could have targeting on your own team, that would be it.
Oh. I don't know if his teammate's going to like that too much.
Be back in a moment. Now it's good to see Tevin Madison up and seemingly not too bad after that collision.
Yeah, Pete Robertson, we talked about a little friendly fire, almost leg whips Madison in the knee, and that's what sent him to the ground. Didn't seem like too much, but a cleat to the knee never feels good.
No, wouldn't imagine. Second down and one. Out of that timeout, play action, a slant. It's Dotson. They've eaten him up all day with that play action to bring the backers in, and then he hits it over the top of
them. Yeah, and that's what happens when you're running the ball effectively. Those linebackers have to respect it and fill that run gap. And then in behind comes the wide receiver into that soft spot of the coverage. Guess who? Josh Dotson again.
So yeah, now 14 catches for 209.
Career day.
Out of an empty set here. Against a four-man rush, they collapse the pocket. There's a flag down, and that one goes through the hands of Dotson. But a flag down to the backfield in the area of holding.
You're going to be able to see a bit of a jersey pull there.
Holding, offense, number 65. 10 yards from the previous spot, replay second down.
Brady Foltz.
Yeah, he's going to try to hang on for dear life on Brendan Jackson as Boykin leaves the pocket. Excuse me, Pete Robertson.
Should have known, right?
Yeah, Pete Robertson's been around the quarterback all day today. He's a special player. He's got a very bright future.
It's 10 in red. Bright future for that guy, too. First down in 20. Penalties becoming part of the story for TCU today. Try to get a chunk back with Green. And they do. About 8 for him. Demetrius Alston, defensive tackle, ran him down.
As this drive ensues, defensive coordinator David Gibbs talked about when his defense gets tired, just fight to stay in your gap, stay in your lane, because if you're not doing that, I don't know what the problems and issues are in us trying to stop the run. So if it is you, then I can get you help. I can sub you out or do something to counteract that. Right now, TCU putting together a nice drive.
Try to overcome the first down penalty, second and 12. Green motions out. He looks the other way and looks at Dotson. who sprawls out to pull this one in. First down TCU across the 30.
And that's just stealing. They motion Aaron Green out of the backfield and leaves no one on that side of the field to really cover Josh Dotson, a tremendous void in the defense and green grass, as the offensive coordinators call it for TCU. So a boy can always look for the green grass.
Green is a decoy going the other way. Open things up. And he hit Dotson again, an incredible 15 catches today, three of them for touchdowns. Boykin Red Robertson, who bit, and he takes it across the 20.
You can be as athletic as you want, but it's very hard to be trying to cover full speed and stop Trevon Boykin. Boykin's just reading number 10. Robertson on that particular play, and no one there to cover down for Boykin in the run defense.
Previous drive, 16 plays and nothing to show for it. Here's the ninth play of this possession. Boykin throwing one. Turpin, end zone, goes up and gets it, but out of bounds. How about Malik Jenkins sticking with him? Second and 10.
And that was just a play designed for Kevontae Turpin. He's going to run out in motion on what's called a wheel route. And Malik Jenkins does his best to stay with him, and just enough to keep from getting a foot in bounds. Great defensive play.
A guy that's been mostly a special teams contributor his first 2 years. Stuck with a speedy Turpin there. Second and 10 from the 19. Boykin over the middle. That's enough for another first down. Guess who? Josh Dotson, 16th reception of the day. First down and goal.
It's a slant route. It's an in route. Going against this two deep zone. That's that soft spot of the field there in the middle of the field. Boykin's throwing footballs where only Josh Dotson can get to.
Boykin now 28 of 46. 16 of those completions to Dotson. Green cuts it back, and he's in. Touchdown, Aaron Green. And TCU's back in front with an impressive drive.
We talked about the missed tackles of the Texas Tech defense plaguing them this year. Malik Jenkins is going to have a shot. Excuse me, Micah Awe had a shot at him. But once Aaron Green gets to the second level, he's too tough to bring down. Those are the easy tackles you have to make if you want to stop this TCU offense.
Which now has 590 yards. They've run 82 plays. We were talking about them in the first half moving slowly.
Yeah, well, they've turned it on here.
82 plays, 589 yards. Aaron Green with his second touchdown of the day. And TCU in this back and forth game with a 10-play drive back in front. Yards, couple of touchdowns for that guy, Aaron Green, and he caps off a 10-play, 75-yard drive. Josh Dotson was a big part of that possession, been a big part of this game.
He's just having one of those days where he's really the only dependable option they have right now for the TCU offense, with Colby Lissenby out, Emmanuel Porter hurt.
He's nearing a couple of single-game score records. The kick is short. Now they got to deal with Justin Stockton and do so well. Paul Whitmill got their first on special teams. Let's check in with a game break.
Thanks, Joe. A wild finish between number 24 Oklahoma State and Texas. A botched punt puts Oklahoma State in field goal position with seconds to go. Ben Grogan nails the 41-yarder. And remember, last week was a missed PAT that resulted in a loss for Texas against Cal. Final score, Oklahoma State wins 30-27. Joe Brady, back to you guys.
More heartbreak.
Who would have thought special teams would be doing in Texas right now? Unbelievable.
So a TCU back in front. Here's Mahomes in this Texas Tech offense. DeAndre Washington with a nice hole straight up the gut. Crossing the 30. Denzel Johnson with the tackle. And it is enough for a first down. Heck of a day for Washington. 171 yards now. And Mahomes just not himself. Hasn't been since coming up limp early on, diving towards the pylon on their second drive of the game. You mentioned it while we were off air during halftime. Sometimes you come out feeling all warmed up in the first half, but it's different after you spend 20 minutes sitting there.
Well, we injured it in the first half, and all those endorphins and adrenaline wears off once you sit down at halftime for a while.
Tipped in the air. They call it a live ball, and it's TCU football. Traven Howard falls on it after Tipa Galeai knocked it out.
Covered by the defense.
Well, there's an example of it. He couldn't get away from a spot that he normally does when healthy.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to watch because he's trying his best to fight through this, but without a doubt, that is a play. Patrick Mahomes is able to get outside the pocket and escape. Chris Bradley able to get a hand on it. Mahomes trying to...
Ruling on the field of a fumble is under further review.
Mahomes trying to plead his case that he was in the process of throwing the football.
You're right, and it was Bradley, not Galeai. So they will review this.
It will be interesting because his arm motion does come forward as well as the football, and it doesn't appear as if the defender, at least from that angle, was able to tip the ball.
I know just the guy to shed some light on this. Mike Pereira, what do you see?
Well, I see a lot of points and one empty hand, by the way, as the ball to me is coming loose in his hand before it starts forward. The arm, the elbow starts forward a little bit, but actually if you look at the play, you're going to want to see the ball come loose. It's already loose in his hand there before the hand starts forward. That's really that classic empty hand that they talk about. So to me, this is a fumble and a clean recovery.
And even then, Mike, it's got to be indisputable evidence to reverse that call, and there's obviously not enough there to change it.
You know, and this is the referee's toughest call, quite frankly, because, you know, obviously it can be so close, but he really looks control, and that's the issue because the arm is almost always going to go forward, and that key is there total control of the ball in his hand? And so you would have to have that total control and clearly the hand moving forward to reverse it. But to me, he makes a good call in just saying this is a fumble.
After further review, the quarterback's hand was moving forward. It'll be ruled an incomplete.
Wow.
Please reset the game clock to 2 minutes and 14 seconds. It'll be third down.
Shocking us all, Mike.
Shocks everybody. Shocks everybody. That one's a hard one for me to believe because, again, got to be beyond a shadow of a doubt to overturn, and I certainly don't see that at all.
Weird things happen in Lubbock.
I guess so.
You can attribute that to. And I think from this angle, maybe they felt it was hard to discern whether or not he had control. It looked like he might have had enough control. I mean, when I first looked at it, that was kind of my initial thought was his arms coming forward, and he kind of maintained somewhat of control, but I don't know if it's indisputable evidence or beyond a shadow of a doubt based on what the officials called.
Got a feeling that's going to be on Mike Pereira's weekly rules video that he helps us out with each week.
Well, but the key here is, look, Texas Tech still is a big third down here. That's third and long. They know Mahomes is not moving around the pocket quite as much as he has before. We'll see if TCU brings pressure.
So third down and eight. Only third downs they've converted today have been third and short. They only bring four. Deep ball, Lauderdale. Justin makes the play against Corey O'Mealy. First down, Texas Tech, and a gain of 38. Lauderdale slow to get up.
Well, Lauderdale may be down, but Patrick Mahomes is moving a lot better. We talked about TCU sensing that Patrick Mahomes is wounded and can't move quite as well. So they've got one-on-one coverage on the outside, and Lauderdale coming up with the big play. Though at the end of it, hits his head on the ground. You see the matchup they like. Texas Tech wants to work against Corey O'Mealy.
Lonely, lonely spot out there for Corey O'Mealy today.
It's a lonely spot for many cornerbacks. You're always on an island, in particular in the Big 12, when they run so many plays.
First down, play action. Mahomes stumbling. wanted to throw the screen, but it was read well by Bryson Henderson. We've been talking about, there's a flag down right now, by the way. We've been talking about Mahomes and his issue moving around, but still moving this offense. The officials come together with his flag down around the line of scrimmage.
And a smart play there. The screen was read perfectly by the TCU defense, so no reason to try to force anything, just throw it into the ground.
Sideline interference on TCU, 15-yard penalty.
Wow.
First down.
That is the third 15-yard penalty on TCU today.
Well, that was one of the emphasis coming into this year, is giving the officials enough room on the sideline. Not sure if there was a warning at some point earlier in this game to then cause a penalty.
Yeah, it's odd because usually the first time is a warning. Second and third times are 5-yard penalties. You don't get the 15-yarder till the fourth sideline infraction. Traven Howard sticking his nose in and shutting down Stockton.
Yeah, at this point, TCU wants to put pressure on Patrick Mahomes to beat them in the passing game. He's got no choice other than that right now, because it's an empty set for him all alone in the backfield.
He's got time and underthrows Grant. If he puts it on him, that might be a touchdown.
Yeah, you could tell that knee is really affecting everything in his game. Anytime you've got a lower body extremity injury, you can't shift as much weight and as much power into the throw. You're throwing more with your arm, and that's going to cause a lot of inaccurate throws at times. But Patrick Mahomes is a tough guy fighting through this.
And a flag down before this third and 12 play. So perhaps a false start, though Mahomes.
False start. Offense number 56. 5-yard penalty, third down.
It's arguing that it should have been the other way. They get Alfredo Morales. Yeah, it makes it third down and even longer for Cliff Kingsbury's team. Well, you want to be careful here because you don't want to lose out on the opportunity to add points with a field goal.
One spot they like to work to is Jakeem Grant down here in the slot.
Looking Grant's way, instead dumps it off. Washington needs blocks. Fumble! And Grant winds up getting his hands on the ball. I'm not sure that's how they had intended for him to get it. The field goal team will come out on fourth down.
Just Johnny on the spot, but ball security right now becoming a bit of an issue for Texas Tech. Fortunately, falling on that football. The Patrick Mahomes, what was ruled a fumble, overturned. Great tackle, by the way. A TCU defense, they teach you to put your helmet on the football and you'll definitely get it out.
It's Traven Howard. Here's Clayton Hatfield trying to solve the place kicking questions for Texas Tech. And there's a step in the right direction. He's made both of his attempts this year. And this one brings him back to within two. Sold out crowd in Lubbock. And they've been treated to an offensive show. That rain is gone. The sun is out. We got a good finish coming. Two-point game, less than a minute in this third quarter. Joe Davis, Brady Quinn, Chris Budden back at Jones Stadium. To go back to that first quarter, you just brought it up. What happened?
There's a safety.
Yeah.
And that's the difference in this ball game right now. A miscommunication between the center, Jared Caster, and Patrick Mahomes, and TCU up by two now.
Without that safety, we'd have a tie game, but I think plenty of ways to go to decide how this one finishes. Well, this fall, Fox brings you an hour of all-star comedy. We've got Grandfather with John Stamos and Josh Peck. I promise we've got it. The Grinder with Rob Lowe and Fred Savage as well. The fall's funniest premieres this Tuesday on Fox. I told you it was coming. I wasn't lying.
Yeah.
There it is.
John Stamos. Those Oikos commercials.
Love yogurt.
Love that yogurt.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. Fred Savage grew up watching The Wonder Years. Not too many people probably remember that show. Old Winnie. His love interest.
You're good. I don't know if that's pop culture anymore. That's just good history lesson from you. Drive starts at the 25. Boykin T to a wide open Josh Dotson, who makes Nelson miss and accelerates across the 40. The guy's got 16 catches today, and you're giving him a 10-yard cushion.
Well, and they keep isolating him one-on-one versus Justice Nelson. They motion Aaron Green away, and they push the coverage, and they beat it on a slant, an in route. Now they come back with a simple 9-yard stop route. He runs 9 yards, he stops. Trevon Boykin puts the ball on him. Texas Tech cannot win right now matching up with Josh Dotson.
Boykin steps up in the pocket, flag down. Look out from behind. Gary Patterson would have loved to have seen him go down, but able to avoid serious contact. But again, a flag in the backfield.
Holding, 77 of the offense, 10-yard penalty, previous spot. Replay first down.
So another TCU penalty. Josh Dotson, we were just talking about, 17 catches today. That's the most by any player in a game this year.
We still have a whole other quarter to play, and I don't think TCU is going to change whether or not they go to Dotson every single pass player. They should. Texas Tech hasn't stopped him yet. It's unbelievable.
More than 600 yards of offense for the Horned Frogs that Dotson has contributed to. Third quarter clock winding down. And they will run a play. Boykin pulled it and went down. Pete Robertson will bring this third quarter to a close with a tackle for loss. What a finish we got coming in this one. The Big 12 opener between a pair of high-powered offenses showing off today. Couple of unbeaten teams. Winner moves to 4-0. Back for the fourth after this. Fox College Football is presented by GEICO. Back here for the fourth quarter as they whip. And Nene, I'm told.
I don't know what that is.
No, it is. It's been an offensive show, as we expected. 40-38, TCU with a football and a second down and 22 to start this fourth. Only three-man rush, so time to scan the field. And White is wide open, but only 5'7", and that's over his head, third and 22.
Yeah, he's not quite tall enough to reach that one, but he was wide open. Trevon Boykin's got to try to find a way of settling in and hitting those open targets, even though they're not there early on in his reads. And that's one of the things he wanted to work on coming into this season, was having better patience and better rhythm going to his third and fourth option in the passing game. Now it's third and 22, and if it's me right now, who do you go to? Josh Dotson.
Oh, yeah.
Take a shot up top. The big guy.
And they've converted twice on third down in this relative distance to Dotson today. He looks the other way. Pressure coming. Running away from it. But nowhere close to a first down. Finally, Texas Tech able to take away Josh Dotson on a third down and long. It's fourth down now.
Yeah, great coverage downfield. Long enough to allow number five, Gary Moore, to pressure Trevon Boykin outside the pocket. Nowhere to go with the football. Big time stop for the Texas Tech Red Raiders.
And no Jakeem Grant back there. It's Cameron Batson. Back to return this punt from Perry. It's a line drive. Batson thinks about it, takes it, pays the price. Thrown down inside the 15 by Derek Kindred.
Good gosh, that was vicious. Wow.
One of those moments where you're happy you're now up here with me. Yeah. Wow.
Colin Peanut, there's nothing small about that hit.
No. As Batson found out, stick around. Good one going in Lubbock. Fox College Football presented by GEICO is sponsored by Nissan. Go to NissanHeismanHouse.com to cast your official vote for the next Heisman by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance, and by Chase Freedom. The card is for the essentials. The cash back is for the fun. Back in Lubbock, speaking of fun, 40-38 in this showdown between 3-0 teams. The Big 12 opener, Pat Mahomes back out there battling through what is an apparent lower body injury that he suffered in the second drive of the game. DeAndre Washington has been steady today, a couple of yards, second down.
Michael Downing coming down from the safety position to make that play. And they're really starting to key in on the Texas Tech running game. Texas Tech is going to have to start throwing the football to the outside.
They pump the bubble over the top. Grant running loose. Jakeem Grant across midfield. Staying on his feet. Downing pulls him down at the 40 after 44 yards and a Tech first down.
Just a beautiful play design by Texas Tech, faking the screen. And then really the downfield shot on the wheel out to Jakeem Grant,
who's been relatively quiet today. Here's Giles, able to turn the corner and get a nice first down gain as we go back to that beautiful design.
So they're going to fake the screen, and then they're going to have Reggie Davis running a post. And there's Jakeem Grant running down the sideline with no one on him. It's the last thing you want to do versus this Texas Tech offense.
Over 100 yards on the game now with his fifth catch. TCU had done a good job of limiting him before that play. Second down and six. Justin Stockton has been bottled up today by TCU, but surprisingly, they've used him between the tackles.
Yeah, I mean, you really got to get a guy like Justin Stockton out in space. When he's on the field, he's the fastest player for either team. And that's saying a lot considering how much talent TCU has on their offensive side of the football.
Third down, five or six. Early on in the fourth quarter. Mahomes looking to the sideline, and it looks like Texas Tech will burn a timeout. Cliff Kingsbury's first. Two left for Tech. Down two. Fox College Football is presented by Geico. Clearly pain for Mahomes from up here. Chris Budden, you've got a good look down there.
Well, you guys were talking about that layoff during halftime. So in between offensive series, he's on the bike, constantly walking, trying to keep moving, but wincing in a lot of pain, Joe.
All right, battling through it.
And you got to keep it moving. That's the only way to avoid a lot of that pain kind of setting in. The more you stand still, the worse it feels. Keep riding that adrenaline rush if you're Patrick Mahomes.
Third down and five out of that timeout. Mahomes making a change at the line of scrimmage. That box is light. They'll still throw it on the out. It's Grant. Can't get away. What a tackle by the true freshman Montrell Wilson. So fourth down, and you would assume they'd go for it from the 33.
A lot of time left, but I think it's more of a situation. They don't feel confident enough in their kicking game to be able to kick one from this distance.
This is where you really miss Mahomes' running ability.
Yeah, but you've got Jakeem Grant, and he's able to get it open versus anyone, in particular Denzel Johnson for TCU.
0 for 2 in these situations today. Mahomes with this great drop. Pocket collapsing. Doesn't matter that he's hurt. Scrambles 5 yards for the first down. The sophomore digging deep to move the chains.
And what a gutsy game Patrick Mahomes is playing right now. He's looking for Jakeem Grant. Sees a running lane and takes it. He's able to get just enough for the first down. We saw him earlier scamper into the end zone for a touchdown. Just a gutsy performance by Patrick Mahomes.
First down from the 29. Well protected over the middle. Dropped by Washington. You maybe heard Bradley and all 6'2", 275 pounds coming at him. Second down.
And that was exactly what Texas Tech wanted. Yeah, DeAndre Washington matched up with number 20 Montrell Wilson. He had some green grass to run after this football, but couldn't bring in the catch.
Eighth play of this drive for Texas Tech, extended by the fourth down conversion. Washington has 173 tonight. There's a flag down as he crashes over the 25. This is going to be on TCU. Judging by the reaction of the Tech players.
Personal foul. Illegal hands to the face. Number 57 of the defense. Half the distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
Third personal foul today on the TCUD.
Davion Pearson at the point of attack. You can see he's got his hand up on the face mask of number 73, Justin Murphy. Pearson not starting today, his first game back this season. Sometimes you get winded and your conditioning's down, start resorting and getting lazy with your technique.
Outside quickly, Cameron Batson pushed out of bounds by Orr. Each of the first two personal foul penalties, Tech followed it by immediately putting it in the end zone. What do they do here?
Looks like they're about to do the same. Again, running at that hyper speed on offense.
Washington pulled down by Galliai, and it's third down and two for the Red Raiders.
Coming into this game, TCU was one of the better teams on third down defense, and Texas Tech was on offense. Tech so far got the better of them.
Mahomes keeps it and stumbles close to a first down. Heroic stuff right now from Mahomes.
Well, Mahomes wasn't able to get in the end zone, but he got enough for the first down. That's all grit, that's all toughness of Patrick Mahomes.
Washington caps it off, touchdown, Texas Tech.
You can't say enough about how tough Patrick Mahomes is playing right now and the way he's leading this team. When I'm looking at this, this is the eighth start he's had. Has already put up better numbers than Graham Harrell, Cliff Kingsbury, two of the most dominant passers in Texas Tech history at the quarterback position.
Hatfield adds the extra point. Back and forth we go. 45-40, Texas Tech. After the conversion from Mahomes, Washington crashes in. Red Raiders looking for their fourth win over a top five opponent in Lubbock in the last decade and up in the fourth. Plenty of people that don't care who wins this game excited about that last extra point. Washington gets his fourth touchdown of the day, the most by a running back at Texas Tech since 2009. And it's 45-40. Red Raiders back in front. Turpin bringing it out. Makes one man miss. Hurdles into a mess. That guy's fearless. Well, the Heisman Trophy is actually in the house today as we take a look at the Nissan Heisman Watch here at the back end of September.
Yeah, Nick Chubb, three touchdowns today. Leonard Fournette, 244 yards and two touchdowns. Boykin having a day as well. Myles Garrett trying to give the defense a little bit of love. 5.5 sacks, 16 tackles in three games. They play tonight. Have a chance to improve those stats, but a big part that Texas A&M defense and how well he's played. And I don't know if we'll have many chances for sacks tonight playing against Arkansas.
Yeah. Who Texas Tech beat last week.
Yeah, like to run the football a little bit.
They do. Looking for another revenge win. They lost 82-27 in this game last year. Turpin finding a seam. Stepped out of the tackle to Jashawn Johnson. Then Mike Awe brought him down. Second down.
Jashawn Johnson's does a great job at coming down from a secondary to make tackles. We talked about him last week versus Arkansas having 16 tackles for his size. 5'10", 175. Small guy, but physical player. Has a nose for the football.
Ripped the ball away from Alex Collins on one play as well.
Yeah.
Big 12 player of the week on the defensive side. Here comes pressure. Boykin beats it with a throw. Jarrison Stewart into the vacated area. First down.
Well, Johnson was there in coverage, but didn't really put a hand in. I don't know if he didn't see the ball come out of Boykin's hand. He was standing right next to Jarrison Stewart.
You saw Stewart wince, but boy, who do they have left at this point to replace him? He's in for Listen B. Emmanuel Porter got banged up earlier. They're already without Deontay Gray at receiver. Try to survive all these injuries. Green hits the hole hard, and Aaron Green has a first down into Texas Tech territory.
Aaron Green won the late hit on number 15, Keenan Ward. But both offensive lines right now are really getting after the defensive front for each defense. Really running the football and really wearing down the defensive lineman for both teams.
That was the right guard Brady Foltz getting to the second level with a key block on that play. From the 45, another first down and 10.
Green again, seam off the right side. Another TCU first down. Johnson with a tackle after 20 more yards for Green.
And one of the keys is really the big boys up front doing a good job of holding up two guys. They got a two gap, that's what it's called. Demetrius Alston not necessarily getting his hands on Brady Foltz.
Same play. They continue to pound over that right side. This time Allen made the tackle.
That's why it's so important for the defensive linemen. They'll do their job, hold up the offensive linemen, not let them get to the second level. To be able to get after Micah Awe, Dakota Allen, Malik Jenkins. Those guys got to be able to stay free and make plays on the running back, but they can't if they've got a big right guard in their face. I'm talking about Brady Foltz.
All 6'4", 320 pounds of him. After the heavy load for Green, he comes out. Kyle Hicks comes in. All 11 men within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage. Hicks hits the hole with a first down and a touchdown. Kyle Hicks explodes through and puts TCU back in front in this roller coaster of a Big 12 opener.
Defensive coordinator David Gibbs tries to adjust, puts an extra guy down around the line of scrimmage. Look how many bodies are up at the line of scrimmage trying to stop the run. The hard part about it is if you don't maintain your gap integrity, all of a sudden you got a running back running with no one in the secondary to stop him.
And it looks like they're going to go for two to try and make the lead three.
Josh Dotson at the top of your screen. One-on-one coverage, not a bad matchup.
Direct snap. Nixon wants to throw it. He does. Did Boykin catch it? You bet he did.
Don't know if they needed that much to get the two-point conversion, but it looks like the double reverse pass back to Boykin, who's got some experience playing wide receiver. He's at the line of scrimmage. He's going to leak out into the end zone, and Nixon with the throw just good enough. This will be a good angle to see if it will be upheld, and it will not.
You don't think?
No, I think to me right there, that's beyond a shadow of a doubt that the ball was able to hit the ground simultaneously as his hands came to the side.
Boy, get your shotgun out. Shoot that duck. Nixon just threw.
I don't know that anyone thought he was going to be able to come in and drop a dime. He's going to take that glove off.
Yeah. That was a six-play, 79-yard scoring drive either way.
And they've used Nixon before in different positions, but not necessarily throwing the football, more in that wildcat position. Watch as the nose of the ball touches the ground.
Yeah, I tend to agree with
you. Trevon Boykin's not able to get his arms or forearms underneath the football to secure the catch.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands.
Wow.
2 points.
And now there's the caveat, Brady, is that on the field it was called a reception, so you've got to have beyond a shadow of a doubt to overturn it.
Could we say a makeup call? There was one earlier in the game that Texas Tech looked like it was going to go the other way, but that one was reversed. Now we've got this one, so a bit of controversy in some of these calls.
Yeah, it stands, 3-point game. Fox College Football presented by GEICO is sponsored by Pizza Hut. Bring home the flavor only at Pizza Hut. 1,154 yards and 93 points in a game that has 8 lead changes. Normally you give lead change numbers in basketball games.
Yeah. Joe, I think you drove that distance from Dallas-Fort Worth to Lubbock.
It was something like that. Yeah, the yards were a little more fun than the drive. That one's buried into the back of the end zone. A couple of controversial calls in this game. Let's bring in Mike Pereira again, our rules expert. What do you think?
Well, I think that Brady, you and I are a bit snake bit on this one because, you know, when you look at this 2-point conversion, to me, it's almost simultaneous when the possession was gained, when the ball hit the ground, then it popped loose a little bit. To me, I also think this is an incomplete pass. The ball's on the ground immediately. So I think that's incomplete. But then again, the one earlier, which was the pass fumble play, clearly to me is a fumble. We've looked at it a zillion times here. Watch, the ball's going to pop out of his hand. before the hand starts forward. Now, again, that was ruled on the field as a fumble. And if that is beyond a shadow of a doubt not a fumble, then I think I've somehow lost the perspective of replay. So, to me, pretty questionable decisions here.
All right, Mike, we appreciate the insight. This drive starts at the 11 because on that kickoff, which didn't even have a return, there was a personal foul penalty on Texas Tech that moves it back half the distance to the goal. They get a few on first down with Washington. Second down and 7 with 8 minutes left.
And as we wind down towards the end of this game, every yard matters. You better believe penalties in the fourth quarter are going to hurt some of these drives Texas Tech is trying to keep alive to stay in this game.
TCU shows some pressure. They only bring 4, so Mahomes with time to take a shot. Incomplete. Looks like nobody knew that it was coming. And he's saying, man, Reggie Davis, run under it. Going again after O'Mealy.
A little bit of a miscommunication, one to take a shot downfield. And I'm all for it, because right now TCU is really staying up around the line of scrimmage to stop DeAndre Washington in the run.
Third down and 7, big play in this game.
Look for the matchup to Jakeem Grant. Patrick Mahomes signaling down that direction.
Mahomes steps into the pocket. Long throw for Davis and a first down. Up to the 35, going at O'Mealy again. 19 yards to move the chains.
So that's the matchup they've been working all game. One-on-one coverage versus number 2, Corey O'Mealy. Reggie Davis on the same page on that time for the conversion.
They pump the bubble and look long. Instead, he comes back to his second read and will throw it incomplete, although Washington came open at the last moment and probably was off to the races if Mahomes had waited a split second longer.
Yeah, again, a bit of a miscommunication on a scramble drill. DeAndre Washington worked upfield and came back. Patrick Mahomes was trying to pump him back upfield again. He threw the ball, but unfortunately not on the same page. That's tough a lot of times when you're talking about after you already drawn up play.
Second down and 10. Underneath they go. That's Giles, quickly eliminated by Denzel Johnson. And another third down and 7.
Giles, only a couple catches coming into this game, really playing a key role with number 12, Ian Sadler, out. He's usually that guy who's running across the middle and sitting in those zones. Texas Tech will now look to try to convert again, another third down.
Converted it last time with a 19-yard throw to the sideline to Davis. On third and 6, well protected again. Coverage is solid. He tries to take off. Turns the corner. And a first down. The legend of Patrick Mahomes built it.
You can't ask for anything more by this offensive line. So stout up front, just throwing the TCU defensive line to the line of scrimmage. And DeAndre Washington at the end, laying a block on Nick Orr to allow his quarterback to get the first down.
Jakeem Grant steps out of a tackle and tripped up by Michael Downey.
Texas Tech has got to start utilizing Justin Stockton, number 4, just came into the game, and Jakeem Grant. Get those guys the ball in space. They'll be sitting in better positions on third down. Jakeem Grant hobbling a bit.
Really one big play for him. Quiet otherwise. Second down. He rolls with pressure from behind. They throw back. There's Stockton. Watch this speed. For the goal line. Touchdown. Texas Tech and Justin Stockton.
This is just brilliant play design by Cliff Kingsbury and his staff. It's a design rollout to the right. Justin Stockton's going to leak down the left sideline. And Mahomes is going to have just enough on this to get it to Stockton where he can make a guy miss. And watch as Kindred doesn't take a good enough angle to be able to get Justin Stockton. He's just too fast. Very deceptive.
You set a beautiful design, and they finally get Stockton outside. A 50-yard touchdown to put Texas Tech in front inside of 6 minutes. We knew it'd be fun. We knew there'd be a lot of points. I don't think we knew it'd be this fun. 100 points total. Patrick Mahomes, he said, don't jump too high. I know you're hurting. Of 37 for 343 yards, and now a couple of touchdowns for Mahomes, and we've been talking about Stockton's speed all day, and finally we saw.
Yeah, I mean, you see what he's able to do once he gets in the open field. Texas Tech hasn't been able to get him out there yet besides that last play. They've been keeping him bottled up inside, but there you see his explosive capabilities. They try to get him the ball about 10 times a game, they say, and that's where he really makes a lot of his yardage on those 9th and 10th plays.
That was his 10th touch of the game. Turpin back to return this. And Gavonte Turpin hits the seam hard, and a solid return out across the 45. You know, Texas Tech is far from comfortable with his 4-point lead, and one of the nation's top offenses ready to go back to work as we check in with Jenny for a game break.
Well, Joe, looks like you guys are in for a wild finish today. How about this one in the swamp between Tennessee and Florida? Will Greer finds Antonio Callaway, and he does the rest down the sidelines for the touchdown, 63 yards. Tennessee missed a long field goal at the final whistle, and the Gators shocked the Volunteers 28-27.
Hashtag college football. Pretty good, huh?
Big win for Florida. Really needed that one. Tennessee and Florida, too, the Blue Bloods in the SEC.
Boykin now working against his Texas Tech defense and this sellout crowd. All day, and then a whistle. There are flags down.
Prior to the snap, delay a game on the offense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
How do you have a delay on the first play of a drive?
I have no idea. I mean, especially coming out of a stop clock, that should never happen. I think you got to credit it to this environment here in Lubbock.
Aaron Green slips a tackle, gets back the penalty yards to midfield. Stop made by Pete Robertson. Second down and 7. 5.5 left.
Pete Robertson just having a big day, getting after Trevon Boykin in the pass rush and falling back and making a lot of plays. That's not his gap. That's not his responsibility. That's just all effort and hustle.
They rush only 3 on second down. 8 in coverage. Boykin extending the play. Jawan Story watches it bounce. And it's 3rd down. David Gibbs told us yesterday that he knows points are going to be scored. He knows that TCU is going to rack up yards. But he said his job will be done if he can get the ball back to his offense at the end of the game with a chance to win. 3rd down and 8. 5 minutes left. Boykin in trouble, and it's 4th down.
And David Gibbs has to love that. He was able to play man-to-man coverage, only had a 3-man rush, and still able to get to Trevon Boykin. The Texas Tech defense coming up big. This is something we haven't seen them do all year long.
Really, more than that, in years, we've not seen Texas Tech's defense play a role. And again, they've given up 48 points. But a big stop here. TCU punts it away. Batson lets it sail over his head. Not wanting to risk a mistake there, I suppose. And it bounces out of bounds at the 13. Well, this has been fun, and this one's going to be fun, too. Top 20 matchup from Eugene. 13th ranked Oregon, 18th ranked Utah. After we finish here in Lubbock, Gus, Joel, Molly on the call of that one.
That'll be a good one. Never been to Otson, heard great things. Talk about two running backs. Royce Freeman, Devontae Booker, two of the best in the Pac-12. We've got two running backs who've been very effective today, and DeAndre Washington for Texas Tech. And Aaron Green for TCU.
The crowd is confused what those signals were. They're saying be quiet.
Yeah.
And they're thinking that they're saying make some noise. Mahomes wants to be able to have his offense hear his cadence. Trying to drain some clock. Running that 4-minute offense. They go to Washington. So many times you see spread teams struggle in these spots.
Yeah, and the one thing that's going to hurt Texas Tech right now is Patrick Mahomes not being as mobile due to that knee injury he's dealing with. So this is where the big boys up front, it's where they make their living. They got to be extremely stout and try to find ways to get up to that second level and try to block the extra defender, because you better believe TCU is going to have an additional guy up around the line of scrimmage to stop the run.
So do you take a shot if you're Texas Tech?
Not right now. Although you've got two big play backs in your backfield with Stockton and DeAndre Washington. They can break one on their own.
On second and six. It's Stockton. And it's third down. Denzel Johnson there for the tackle inside of 4 minutes. Still all three timeouts for TCU. And a third down and four for the Red Raiders.
Third and four, a crucial situation. Probably going to get man-to-man coverage on the outside. Who do you try to work to? I think Jakeem Grant. Although they've picked on number two, Corey O'Malley, down at the bottom of your screen quite a bit. Grant at the top of your screen.
Empty snap for Mahomes. Grant motions into the formation. They rush only three. Mahomes extends the play and throws incomplete. And Gary Patterson's defense, which has defined this program over the last two decades, forces a three and out to get it back to the O with 3:11.
Yeah, huge stop. And his defense coming into this game was one of the best in the country on third down. But Texas Tech has got the better of them today. Right there, TCU's defense that comes up big.
Samank ready to punt it. Kevontae Turpin waits back. It's a line drive. It takes a TCU bounce and rolls out of bounds at the 47. We welcome you inside one last time to set this final three and a half up. Joe Davis, Brady Quinn, it's been as advertised and then some.
Yeah, and in this case, I think it's going to end up being the team with the ball last who's going to win this game. Both defenses have struggled at times throughout the course of this game. So we'll see if TCU can answer here, and then the pressure will be on Patrick Mahomes and Texas Tech.
47-yard line, first down and 10, 3 minutes left. Jarrison Stewart across midfield. The freshman playing the biggest role that he has in his career. With a gain of six, second down and four.
Yeah, the injury to Ty Slanina really opens up Jarrison Stewart for a big opportunity here. Only three catches coming into this game.
Aaron Green off the right side makes a cut in the hole for a TCU first down.
You almost get the feeling that TCU scoring is inevitable. You would never want to let them score, but you want to leave yourself enough time at the end of the game to be able to respond.
This one has a little bit of the feel of that TCU Baylor game from last year. The Baylor won late. Boykin to throw, all kinds of time. Strong arm to the outside, Jawan Story. And fighting his way for close to a first down, working against J.J. Gaines. They spot him right at the marker as we wind near 2 minutes. And it is enough for a TCU first down.
And one guy's name we haven't heard a lot in recent drives for TCU is Josh Dotson. Kind of gotten away from working to him for whatever reason. You'd think they'd want to utilize that matchup. He's been dynamic all day.
17 catches for 251 yards. First down run for Green. Got away from Alston. Dotson unable to get the block on Tevin Madison. They're still able to get a solid first down game. A minute 40. Two timeouts left for Texas Tech. You start thinking about when to use those.
Yeah. Tevin Madison making a nice play. Had a big game last week with 11 tackles and a nice interception. Usually cornerbacks aren't that great at tackling, but Tevin Madison, he can get the job done.
Boykin for Dotson. Slung it into a tight window, and Dotson pulled it in to set up first and goal. There he is, 18th catch of the day.
And he's just too much for one guy to cover. You got to find a way of doubling him, and that opens up too much in the running game.
Aaron Green downhill to the two. And don't you figure for Cliff Kingsbury, you got to start using the timeouts?
Yeah. Although TCU sure isn't trying to milk the clock. They're playing as fast as they can.
Timeout, Texas Tech.
There we go.
One left. And again, they need a touchdown in this spot. 18 catches ties the Big 12 record. He had 17 in the first three quarters. That was his first of the four.
And he's just unstoppable. He's going to be working up top on the screen on a little in route. Boykin does a nice job looking off number 15, Keenan Ward, to open up that window. As we said before, Josh Dotson's too good to single up in one-on-one coverage. You got to find someone else to put over there on that side of the field to not allow that to happen. But credit Boykin, credit Dotson. They've really got it going this game, and he's picked up the slack. You look at 18 catches, that doesn't even count how many targets he's had.
Yeah.
He's been their entire passing game. This is an offense that had 14 different receivers touching the ball coming into the game.
So a minute five with a second down and goal at the four. You're running it, you're giving Dotson a chance.
No, you're running the football. I mean, you also want to take as much time off the clock as you can. The Texas Tech defense is tired. So make those guys, make Texas Tech use their timeout, run the football in if you can. Look how many bodies are up around the line of scrimmage, though.
Green, right side, slipped a tackle into the arms of Fajoko. And it's third and goal inside of a minute now. And there's the final timeout used by Texas Tech. Cliff Kingsbury's all the way down to the 7-yard line to call it.
Usually you'd think 54 seconds left in the game isn't much time for a team to put a drive together, but Texas Tech has done it all day.
And well done by Coach Kingsbury, because here's the thing now, if you're TCU, I mean, it's third down. Field goal does you no good. So you're done trying to toy with the clock and run time. Now, bottom line, you got to get the ball in the end zone.
Yeah. And if you're TCU, the smart thing to do here, you got to have two calls. I would try to run the football first. So if you don't get in, you're taking more time off the clock. And then you got your second call to go to. And I can tell you what, it should be a fade ball to Josh Dotson.
Huh.
And that's exactly how I'd play out this scenario. Get the best of both worlds. You work time off the clock, and you get a potential score.
Trying to extend the nation's second longest winning streak to 12 games. On the ropes in Lubbock. Third down and goal. Speed option. Boykin is shut down. It's Allen with a stop. One play to decide it.
And don't be surprised if TCU doesn't use one of their timeouts here to get the right call after they get some time off the clock. They've got only 40 seconds left in the game. That play clock, the differential is about 14, 15 seconds. So they're going to wind this thing down and put it all in this one last fourth down play.
And so that timeout taken with 29 seconds. What do you think of the speed option call?
I mean, it was what I was talking about. You want to try to run the football here? I think you got two of your best runners and athletes on the field. Really, Dakota Allen coming up big with the stop on Boykin as he tries to cut it up behind Vitae. But I love the call. Running speed off, she's still running the football, giving her a chance to work some time off the clock.
So you're still thinking fade to Dotson now with one chance?
Yeah, I think so at this point, and especially if they have him isolated up in one-on-one covers. They haven't stopped him yet. Why wouldn't you?
Yeah. Seconds. Fourth down and goal, TCU.
That's the matchup at the top of your screen I'd want to work to. It's the near side of the field, an easier throw. You've got a nice height advantage.
Boykin throwing, too tall. It was pulled in. Green caught it. Do you believe it? Aaron Green off of the deflection. Touchdown, TCU.
obviously not how you draw it up, but the tip ball from Josh Dotson ends up being caught by Aaron Green. And it looks as if he does get a foot down. And again, pressure is on the officials now in the replay booth.
Which has been a story all afternoon. Off of the fingertips of Dotson, into the waiting hands of Aaron Green for only his third catch of the season.
And credit Aaron Green for getting in the end zone. A lot of running backs wouldn't think to try to follow the ball in the play. But what a job, what a day for Aaron Green.
That was quick. Here's your critical verdict.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
Panic, despair, and Lubbock, and back in Fort Worth, they're losing their minds right now.
Those bottles coming on the field was tortillas earlier in the game. Now it seems like little harder objects.
That's the type of play you'll see for years.
Please refrain from throwing objects on the field.
And I keep going back to the safety in the first half of the game. That would make this PAT much more meaningful, and then you'd be talking about 20 seconds left and the opportunity for Texas Tech to go down and kick a field goal. Not necessarily what the position they want to be in, but at least the chance to win, and instead now would be a field goal to tie.
Boykin's throw is off the mark, but miraculously, on a season where TCU has had nothing but bad luck with the injuries, a season's worth of good luck falls into the arms of Aaron Green. And Oberkrom's extra point makes it a three-point game with 23 ticks left for Patrick Mahomes to try and pull a trick out of his own bag. The Dr. Pepper one-of-a-kind play of the game. What do you think? I think we go to this
Not
one.
How you draw it up, but the matchup I would have worked towards. They try to double him. Deshaun Johnson tries to get over in time, but Aaron Green there with the assist from Josh Dotson. You knew they had to throw the ball into the end zone based on the situation. You knew he was going to put it up high. Not that high, though. Nice job by Aaron Green.
How about the reaction from Gary Patterson, who finally smiles? That's the one-of-a-kind Dr. Pepper play of the game, which is not over. 23 seconds in a three-point game, but no timeouts for Texas Tech. This has been as wild of a college football game as you will ever see. Back and forth we've gone with 11 lead changes. Josh Dotson has tied the conference record with his 18 catches. His most important play, perhaps one he didn't catch. Bump, set, catch for Green in the back of the end zone. And a game with 183 plays. And a couple more coming here. Out of the back of the end zone, so from the 25. And again, a field goal does tie it, but the longest field goal this season for Texas Tech is 33 yards.
Yeah, and if you're looking at this scenario, you're trying to think to yourself, how do we work the ball down the field? With 23 seconds, you'd like to try to work the sidelines, some quick throws to the outside, allow your wide receivers to get up the field, but also stop the clock out of bounds. But let's not forget, too, the clock stops after a first down. So it allows you opportunity to rush up, spike the ball. Now Mahomes battling a knee injury. Might be a little tougher for him to be able to scoot around in the pocket and make plays and even run up after a big completion downfield.
Been a heroic performance from him. Faces a four-man rush. And that ball, hopefully for Texas Tech's sake, is incomplete because it would have been short of the sticks and clock might have run out.
Yeah, with 17 seconds left, that's too close to try to get into play in the middle of the field and get up and spike it. A lot of moving parts there. They're going to have to try to keep throwing the ball to the sidelines and working the ball up the field that way and hope you've got a shot for a Hail Mary.
And again, in the stadium, it says 17 seconds, so 17 seconds on the game clock. Get it in the hands of Jakeem Grant, and he'll run out of bounds to stop the clock with 11 seconds with the ball at the 35.
You can do that one more time. But from this spot in the field, I don't know if Patrick Mahomes with a bad knee will be able to get it all the way to the end zone.
You bring Davis Webb in, let him chuck it as far as he can?
Possibly.
No timeouts. Again, like you said, probably one more play to set up a heave-ho. Oh, Lauderdale ran before he caught it. 9 seconds on the stadium clock. We apologize for the technical difficulties.
And this is cutting it close. But every yard helps, in particular the quarterback who is going to have to buy some time to make throws.
Going outside again. And incomplete. That ball hit the ground. So 3 seconds. You've got one last play.
So what you'd like to do here is you're going to throw the ball in the field of play, and you're going to have to pitch it around. They're going to have to basically keep lateraling it and see if they can work their way down the field, because there's obviously not enough time in this game, and Patrick Mahomes just can't put enough on the football to get it down the field from where they're at.
So last chance here for Texas Tech in what would be a heartbreaking defeat. There's a flag down. This perhaps is a free play. Mahomes will load up, chuck it deep to the goal line. And it is picked off, it appears. But again, there's a flag down back at the line of scrimmage. I think they're going to get to try this again.
And if with the gain in yardage, look where that ball fell.
Ooh.
I think he can get it to the end zone.
Yeah, I think you're done questioning how far he can throw it with a bad knee, right?
Yeah. Well, he got everything into that throw.
There are two fouls on the play, both against the defense. Offside, number 94. That penalty is declined. Personal foul.
Wow.
Bluffing the passer.
Wow.
Number 97. That penalty be enforced. We'll have one untimed down.
So, Brady, the fourth personal foul of the day moves the ball to midfield for the last chance.
Chris Bradley at the very end of the play takes the unnecessary shot. And now Texas Tech's got life.
An untimed down. Mahomes setting his feet, trying to get room in the pocket, extending the play. Can he get one off? He does float it downfield to Washington. Can they make an open field tackle? Pitch the ball to Andre. He does to the Raven Clark. It's flipped back to Lauderdale. He throws it to Grant, hurtling his way to the 10. TCU survives barely.
Well, obviously not how you draw it up.
No, you
but
think?
But what a play by Patrick Mahomes just to get the ball off to DeAndre Washington. He does the correct thing in flipping it back. The Raven Clark flips it. One more pitch to Jakeem Grant. You wish he could have just thrown the ball back and kept it alive. But credit the TCU defense for trying to protect the Hail Mary and then coming up and stopping the pitch around play.
Wow, I think we need a break. Rob Levin on the other side with more great college football.